Ron and Fez here with you. On a very sad day in New York.
Ron Bennington, Fez Watley, 102.7 WNEW. We're going to hang around with you for a couple hours. You know the story. If there's places for news, there's other places to go much better than us. I recommend 1010 Wins. If you're there at TV, turn on CNN. But if you just want to talk, 877-692-1027. Fez mentioned the saddest day maybe in the history of New York, Fezzy. Our city, the city we love, attacked.
Absolutely under attack. Of course, the World Trade Center is gone. Nothing new to you. Nothing, that you haven't heard already today.
What a day it was.
But, you know, everyone who's finally made their way home, here's a place where you can talk about it. 877-692-1027.
A lot of different numbers coming in, too, of places that if you've had any kind of experience with medical situations, they're looking for people to help here. Blood donors are needed. We'll give some of those numbers out later on. And also tonight, the president due to speak, and I believe also the Pentagon will have a press conference. So we'll cut away for both of those stories. Tough day all the way around, Fest.
Just awful to wake up in the morning and see what was going on. I actually got up in the morning, went on the computer, looked at the news. There was nothing about it online at the very beginning. Then logged off the computer. Mother called and let me know that a plane had gone into the World Trade Center.
At that time, no idea, of course.
Right.
What was really happening, thinking maybe it was an accident. But, you know, World Trade Center, you had that weird kind of terrorist vibe about it anyway. But you're willing to say, oh, you know, what a horrible thing. You know, especially, remember not too long ago, the silliness down at the Statue of Liberty. So you never know whether it's somebody playing grab ass or close.
Is it another paraglider? You know, just yesterday, there was a banner plane circling the U.N.
Yeah.
It's the UN for Taiwan or something like that.
Yeah.
And then, of course, today being primary day for the mayor's race, I thought, oh, great, some ass face with a, you know, vote for whoever banner ran into the World Trade Center.
So, yeah, that's your initial situation. Fez, actually.
Then it's just a little Cessna, a little crop duster that went into the thing.
Fez, actually, at that time, called my house and woke me up.
Screaming again.
Right.
How many calls like that have you gotten over the years?
And as I'm sitting there watching this on TV, and literally, you know, rubbing my eyes, and the next building explodes, and you see that I turn around to my wife, and I go, we're under attack.
Yeah.
It was like the thing Pearl Harbor. For me, myself, my first thing from there is, I've got to get my kids.
Right.
And I'm sure a lot of people who have children in Manhattan, probably in any borough, and even Jersey and all, because here's what you can almost, you know, the television doesn't pick, is the, you know, people watching us from around the country. We didn't know what it was going on, when it was going to end.
Yeah.
And I mean, an hour later, you're still hearing news stories of explosions, whether it's the Pentagon or that other plane in Pennsylvania. And what a surreal day in New York City.
I walked down the street from where I live to get a better view of the World Trade Center because you can see it from my neighborhood.
Yeah.
And then I would walk back to my apartment and you'd turn the TV back on and something else had been attacked.
Yeah.
You know, and the Pentagon had been attacked. Then there was all kinds of rumors, you know, that Camp David had been attacked.
Well, we will keep an eye on any news stories that will break, and we'll cut away for them, whether it's to 1010 Wins or whether it's to the president or if the Pentagon makes that. But we thought we'd just spend the rest of the night talking with you folks, talking with people about what they went through today, Fez.
Yeah, because everyone's going to be touched by this.
Hey, Tom, you're on the Ron and Fez show. How you doing, buddy?
Hi, Tom.
Oh, all right, hold on. We're working on our first phone call.
Yeah.
Yeah, Tom.
We're on a skeleton crew.
Well, by the way, your delay's not working.
Well, we didn't want to tonight in case some kind of news came through. So everybody is on their best behavior tonight.
Listen, member of the local law enforcement community.
Yeah.
Not NYPD, but a lot of a lot of good guys went to their deaths today.
No doubt about that, Tom.
And
at this point, we have no idea how many.
No. And I just want to express, I mean, I'm sure you guys will agree with me, we can't be afraid. We have to take the stars and stripes out of the closet, hang them outside your window, and don't be afraid, because if we're afraid, the guys that did this win.
Tom, it'll be interesting to see what the president has to say tonight. I imagine that the speech is going to be somewhat like that, where you will hear, I mean, no matter, I mean, it's a horrible thing, and I've already gotten calls from everybody in my family. You know,
oh, yeah.
You want to get out of there, you want to get the kids out of there, and this is our home. Our home was attacked today. It's just incredibly, the fact that that this never happened during World War II to this part of the country.
Right, where the mainland gets attacked.
Right, the mainland was attacked today, and
the capital of the country was attacked.
Yeah, which is almost on the back burner, the Pentagon, because the story out of New York is just so horrifying.
Mm-hmm.
And, also heartbreaking for people that love this city. But at the same time, Tom, you're exactly right. There's no way we can back down here.
No, we can't. I mean, remember the Maine and all that, you know? Well, remember the World Trade Center.
Thank you, Tom. Thanks for calling.
Take care.
877-692-1027.
No matter how you're feeling tonight, go ahead and call in. We're going to be here all night anyway.
Yeah, here's one of our regulars. We wanted to check in, especially for a lot of people who listen to this show. We talked about it and said, you know, what kind of show do we want to do? And we'll just play the town square for people who listen to this radio station, people who listen to this show at nights. Here's Dan from Hoboken. How you doing, Danny?
Hey, what's up, guys?
Hey,
hi, Dan.
Hi. It's, I don't know. You can't really say too much about anything today. You know, it's not a time to even put things into words. You know, my generation doesn't know tragedy. You know, I'm 24 years old. We don't know national tragedy. We didn't.
You're only 24?
Yeah.
God is my witness. I thought you were in your 40s.
Yeah, well. That's a whole other thing he's going to start working on after today.
Right,
hey, Dan, so you're 24 years old. This is the first time.
It's nothing, you know. You put it into perspective. You see the other World Trade Center bombing.
Yeah.
You know, even Oklahoma City, you know.
Right.
It's you know, not to put light on those tragedies, but it's nothing, you know. We know tragedy from movies, and those are completely sanitized at this point. I mean, they have to throw love stories in these, you know, Pearl Harbor epic movies just to tell us, you know, to make my generation feel for it, you know, which is sort of sad, but you know, in another way, it says that, you know, our country grew up today, you know, my generation especially, you know, this is something that's going to unify us as a country, and you know, we may have, you know, lost today, and you know, these terrorists may have won today, but tomorrow we will win, and every day beyond that we will win, because we have a country founded on the principles of Republican democracy under a constitution that's impenetrable. I mean, there's nothing they can do to us that will overthrow our sense of government, our sense of a community. And, you know, it's just, you know, today is the day to hang our heads and to mourn those lost and to, you know, put our hearts out and all our efforts out to those still, you know, in peril. But today is not the day to mourn America.
Well, Dan, you know, you came up with something interesting here because, like you said, you're a young guy and it's your first time you went through something like this. It will be interesting to see how the city and country, what the stages that we go through over the next couple of days, because I guarantee you today's stage is shock.
It's shock.
Oh, yeah. I'm in the denial area.
And, you know, here's something else, Dan, that you brought up interesting about those stupid movies that we watch. I'm running through the city, and I got to make it from my place. I'm taking my kids out of different schools. And I had that running through the city, and it weirdly felt like a strange movie. And as I'm looking up at the World Trade Center, and the smoke is coming out of it, and I can see it, it was so unreal looking that I felt like I was in a movie. I felt like I was in Armageddon or one of those ridiculous movies that we watch. There was just no way I think that anybody really gets how we feel right now, other than the fact that we're shocked, we're hurt, some of us are angry. You know, there's already going to be all the bad jokes out there. I'd rather you didn't do them here tonight.
Sure.
No, but we've been through all those types of things. Tomorrow will bring new experiences, and the day after that will bring even other feelings.
Well, I mean, we cannot expect our way of life to be the same. I mean, personally for me, you know, I was up late last night doing a stupid column, and, like, just think about how ridiculous that sounds.
Right.
You know, the stupid things that are so important to me or to everybody in our lives just become put so much in perspective.
I know. Al Duke's breaking the foosball table doesn't even seem that important today.
Not at all.
Well, he still should fix it. But the point of the matter is, yes, you're right. And, you know, it's weird that... And, you know, here's another strange thing. People from all over the country try to call you when you live in New York. So I can't get away from the phones.
I have thought about friends today that I haven't thought about in weeks. And right now I'm in, you know, my heart's torn up because I don't know what's happened to them. And I just think, well, I haven't thought about them in, you know, a month.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, you know, they're on the top of my mind. And it really does put things in perspective. It puts everything in perspective. And in a terrible way.
Yes, it does.
In a way I would never wish on anybody.
Thank you, Dan, from Hoboken.
Oh, thank you.
Dan, you've never been more coherent.
Yeah.
It's surprising. Maybe
there is no chokey tonight.
Yeah.
Thank you very
much. Thank you, pal. Bye-bye.
See ya.
See you, Dan.
877-692-1027. That's what we thought we'd do with our show tonight. Just talk to people. You know, a lot of the people that we talk to, Alon, a lot of the people that, you know, have never called the show before. And just let people share their emotions tonight. There's really not much else we can do.
No,
Night,
we're not going to do Oscar blurbs or anything.
Night falling pretty quickly here in Manhattan, Fezzy. I expect everybody to be cool tonight and stay in if you need to be in. And, you know, don't go gawking or don't go hanging out tonight.
A lot of people following that advice already. The streets, just ghost towns for the most part.
Yeah,
when I finally was able to get a train in.
It was very, very strange to see those how many people walking across the Brooklyn Bridge, the Queensboro Bridge.
That was very bizarre. Just this march of people out of Manhattan that you would see on television. And actually, I live near the Queensboro Bridge, so I just saw that from down below. Ronnie, you must have caught one of the last trains into the city before they quit running this morning.
I had to come in from Roosevelt Island, and I think I really did catch, because I did it, you know, fairly quickly. I went and got my son at one school, and then when I went for my daughter, I was on probably, they actually stopped me underground for quite a time.
Yeah, because I talked to you, and then I went outside. I walked down the street, like I said, and by the time I walked down by the subway station, they said, you know, there was people being turned back. Saying that, you know, it's not running.
Well, I was stopped underground for, and you know, you don't know how much time it is.
Right.
You know. To me, it felt like...
You get
like,
the feels like time.
For me, the feels like time went on forever. And then I'm underground, and I'm saying, what has happened when I'm under? And honestly, I think why my subway was stopped underground, I think it's when the Trade Center was coming down.
Yeah. The first Trade Center tower that came down... That one I saw while I was standing outside with a bunch of people that were just gathered around watching.
Give me an approximate time on that, Fez. You remember?
Was that like closer to 11? It was 9 o'clock when everything started happening.
Yeah.
And then, like, the one Trade Center got bombed. I think 18 minutes later, the plane flew into the second one.
Yeah.
And then it was probably a good hour, maybe 10:30 after that the first one went.
It's very, very bizarre. All this stuff, only about 10.5 hours, I guess, right?
Mm-hmm.
Since it all happened. In some way, it feels like it's been going on for weeks. In other ways, it's felt like it just happened.
It feels like a very long, long day.
Yeah, or a long, long dream.
Yeah.
A long, strange dream. Hey, Steven, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hi, Steven.
Hey, Ron and Fez. How you doing?
Hey, buddy.
Yes, I had a question.
You got to turn that radio down for us, too, pal. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. I had a question for Ron and Fez.
Yes, go ahead.
I'm 17 years old.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, I'll be 18 this Friday, and I was wondering if, hypothetically speaking, there was to be a war anytime soon, will I be recruited? That's what I was wondering.
I would probably doubt it, Stephen, but, you know.
Yeah, they didn't, you know, reinstate the draft during the Persian Gulf War.
Well,
do they still have the selective service where you have to go to the post office and sign up?
I was just I'll be willing to go tomorrow.
Yeah.
Thank you, Stephen.
As a matter of fact, we heard from our friend Tom today, as he went through Times Square, that a lot of kids were lined up trying to sign up right away.
Really?
Yeah, that a lot of kids had heard this thing happen and just took off for the recruiter. So I guess we'll hear more about that over the next couple of days. But
and, of course, all the reservists have been activated.
Right. Here was the other strange thing. In Manhattan, you don't see any planes in the air except for those military F-14s surfing.
Right.
And it felt like scary and then comfortable all at the same time.
Uh-huh.
Like, well, thank God they're there, but when do you see that over your city?
Being outside and hearing one of those jets or helicopters go by,
yeah,
you know, it was very odd because you think, oh my gosh, plane means something.
Right.
It's going to fly into something. Because you just, when they took out the first tower and then the next tower and then the Pentagon went,
yeah,
you thought, well, how much longer is the Empire State Building going to be sitting there?
Yeah, sure. That exactly was going through my mind as I was running and trying to get my kids today, is that at no time did I feel like, okay, this is over, the worst is behind us.
Right.
I'm thinking, what the hell is next? And you know, you're trying to push those things out of your mind so you can be the adult.
And you know that this attack happened, you know, after 9 o'clock when everybody was pretty much at work that was going to work, and you think, oh, is this something that's going to go along the time zones? You know,
right,
when the people on the West Coast in Los Angeles, when they get into work, is there someplace out there that's going to get the next plane?
Or hearing that these guys were able to pull off four different hijackings.
Stealing four jet airliners.
Yeah.
From two different airlines.
Now, I think I was listening, I think it was the ONA show today. Oh, wait a minute, hold on. Here's a toll-free number just handed to us. Information on victims, family, survivors, any kind of information that you're looking on that type of material, 1-800-331-0075, 1-800-331-0075. I just got this from the Hawk, and I guess this is if you can't find somebody,
right,
somebody in your family, here's the number to call, 1-800-331-0075.
And we'll keep giving that out through the evening.
Also, we'll give out some other numbers a little later on. There's also numbers. Do you have that one, Fez, that if you are have any kind of medical background, they're looking for volunteers?
No, that one I don't have.
Let me get that from you again, Billy Staples.
We also have a website here if you want to report any information that you might have on today's terrorism. That website, ifcc.fbi.gov.
That's if you think you know something. That's,
yeah,
the situation.
That's what I got handed. Do you have any info on the terrorism today?
Here's another number.
You better not.
Anybody with medical experience, the volunteers are needed. 1-800-628-0193. I'll say that one again. This is anybody that has medical experience. 1-800-628-1093.
So we got plenty of phone numbers. If you need them, give us a call, and we'll give them out again, like I said, throughout the evening. Our phone number, 877-692-1027.
Anyway, Fez, I was mentioning this before this. I think I was listening to the ONA show, and one of their callers brought up the fact that, you know, the airport seemed too lax.
Mm-hmm.
I've never felt that way. I literally feel like I'm under so much suspicion anytime I get on a plane.
Right.
I would not know how you would get a gun on a damn plane.
My mother went to the airport to pick me up when we went on vacation, and she's got her fake knee.
Yeah.
Oh, they about undressed her because her knee was buzzing through the metal detector.
You know, I am always getting yanked over for the side for a cigar clip or a watch,
mm-hmm,
or a ring. I don't know what it is. So, you know, and I'm no expert in this, but people are saying that the airports are lax. I just flew last weekend, and I felt like I was hassled the whole time.
Sure.
So, I mean...
And I've always had to unpack my bag. And trust me, that's embarrassing, the things I carry on a holiday weekend.
Hey, Dennis, you're on the Ron and Fez show. How you doing, buddy?
Hi, Dennis.
Hey, what's going on, guys?
Hey.
I just wanted to let you know that, like, I don't know, it's kind of an update or something of that sort, but... A neighbor of mine has a friend who works in one of the coroner's offices in the city in Staten Island. and they were getting like reports in and stuff that they haven't put into the news yet, but there are reports of like lots of bodies coming. I don't know if it was from the towers or around the towers.
Yeah, I mean, Dennis, I have no idea, you know, what those numbers are going to be. I'd be afraid to even say.
Yeah, it's just out of proportion. Like,
I can't imagine. I mean,
it's just a real situation.
It's not even real yet. Yeah.
When you just start adding up the fact that there was people on the plane, all the thousands, tens of thousands of people in the building, anyone on the ground,
yeah,
you know, when the explosions happen.
Firefighters.
Right, and when the collapses happen.
Yeah. Well, we know the only thing that they're giving out, the only number they're giving out for sure, is the 266 people that were on the planes.
They're for sure about that.
The number of other people is...
It's just unknown now.
It's unknown, and it just seemed frightening to even guess. Thanks a lot, Dennis.
Thanks, guys.
That's what I was talking about earlier, Fezzy, when I said we're going to go through, what other certain stages here that we can't even begin to imagine at this point right now.
Yeah, at this situation, you know, there's... the annoyance of and shock of everything and everything being shut down. And then we're going to, the city will try to get back to normal as fast as possible.
Yeah.
But my gosh, it seems impossible with the mess that's down there.
Yeah.
And the situation. And it's like, do you even feel like bothering?
Well, of course, Fezzy, we will prevail because that's what people do no matter what happens. I mean, you know, I've never seen this type of situation, but I was in Florida when that hurricane hit in South Florida.
Hurricane Andrew.
You know, I remember, you know, just, you know, certain situations, the way the country felt about the space program after the Challenger exploded. And you're like, should we even ever go into space again?
Yeah.
And the fact of the matter was, yes, we will. We're going to do all these things. We're going to rebuild, and we're going to live and work and enjoy our life because that's what we do. And somebody can't take that away from us. And I'm pretty sure that's basically what the president is going to say tonight.
He is going to speak, they're saying now, at 8:30 Eastern Time.
8:30 Eastern Time. And then after that, I would not be surprised to get something out of the Pentagon or...
Mm-hmm. The Pentagon had a real small briefing just a little while ago. Probably about 45 minutes ago.
What a strange, strange day. Hey, Marin, you're on Rana Fest.
Hey, I just felt really weird and sort of quiet all day long until the F-16s came over my house about an hour ago.
Yeah.
And it was just, I walked outside because I heard the rumbling, which was strange to hear some noise at all after a day of kind of silence.
Yeah, where are you located at, hon?
I'm in Rockland County.
Yeah.
I'm in New City. And it was real quiet all day long, and then I heard the rumble of the F-16, which you knew right away it had to be a fighter because, you know, the high-pitched whine of jets is different.
Right.
And just because there's no aircraft, apparently, in the air. You know, you've been told all day that there are no jets flying. And I walked outside, and I'm standing out in the yard, and I saw him go overhead, and he kicked on his afterburners, and you could feel it rumbling. And that was the first time all day I felt good. You know, he kicked in his afterburners. I don't know where he was going or what he was doing, but it felt good to know he was there, you know?
Sure.
And I don't know what kind of stuff is being planned to retaliate or all, but I feel good to know that there are guys out there that are working for this country to keep us good and keep us safe.
Well, there's a lot of people out there tonight.
Yeah.
The firemen, the EMTs, the New York police. The military standing, now probably everybody in the military called in, Fez.
Yeah, yeah, definitely all the, of course, regular personnel and the reservists.
The fact that we had to get every airplane out of the sky today, quickly after we heard this thing happening.
What was it, 40,000 flights grounded?
Yeah.
Amazing number.
Yeah. And this is always the stuff that I'm trying to tell Fez that, you know, Fez is always worried about flying. I'm like, Fez, there's 40,000 flights up at any moment.
Right.
You know, you couldn't be more safe.
And then this happened.
Yeah.
You know, and a flight from Boston, leaving Boston, that's going to head out west, you know, ends up, you know, being steered into the World Trade Center.
Yeah.
You know, those people in Boston, they get on that plane, they have no intention You know, you wouldn't even comprehend. I mean, trust me, I get on a plane, I think a lot of bad things are going to happen.
Right.
But never in my wildest imagination would I expect what happened to those poor people today.
You ever think terrorists when you get on a plane?
Yeah, I think hijacking. But
I never do.
But I always think that not like a bombing,
yeah.
But like I'm just going to end up in the Middle East.
Right.
And it's going to take forever to get back.
Thanks, Baron. You know, back then, you know, before we actually used to have any kind of security at the airport back in, I guess, the 60s and stuff, where people used to hijack planes, take them to Cuba. You can understand all that. They were looking for money. They were looking to steal planes.
Right.
This madness that, you know, people are saying, what do they want? Somebody up there had to not only plan this, but planned it knowing that they were going to die at the end of their little part of this.
Right.
What the hell is in their heads?
And get the glory. A guaranteed spot in the afterlife for being the kamikaze.
All right, here is some other news, of course. You probably guessed this one. New York City schools will be closed tomorrow. They are expected to be open on Thursday, though, Fez.
All right.
So, but for sure, closed tomorrow.
Yeah.
Also, if you family out there and you can't find them and you're concerned, here's the phone number, 1-800-331-0075. That's the information for victims, families, and survivors. Maybe there's the list that they're keeping that, you know, no, he's safe, he's working into the night.
Right.
That type of thing.
Because, of course, everyone's cellular is just out.
And Fez mentioned this earlier, President Bush will be talking at 8:30 tonight, Eastern Standard Time, and not just the city looking to him or the country, the whole world is looking to him now. Anywhere that you go in the world, I mean, the percentage of people who would think that this kind of action is a good idea is tiny, Fez.
Yeah, and we just had a situation where several members of Congress got together and just had a brief press conference. Yeah. I think they just said a prayer, actually.
Right.
It was Speaker Dennis Haskert and Dick Gephardt and just about everyone, it looked like.
All right, Billy and Hawk, if you see that kind of stuff come up on CNN, let us know. We'll cut away for that.
All right. We'll bring that up in here.
Anthony, you're on the Ron and Fez show. How you doing, buddy?
Hi, Anthony.
Anthony Gowen, you there? Okay, we'll let you go. Trying to get to all these calls as quick as we can. Of course, the phone lines, 877-692-1027. We were just going to hang out tonight and take calls.
Yeah, just let you vent.
Here's Steve. Steve, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, what's up, guys? How you doing?
What can we do for you, Steve?
Well, you know, you can't do anything for me. What we could do for our whole entire country is everybody in the areas, just put out an American flag, man. Put it on your porch. And just put it out there and show what you got and say your prayers and thank God that we're America.
Right.
You know what I'm talking about, fellas?
All right.
I mean, just put your flag out there and do what you got to do. Show your support and say your prayers, man. I'm not like I'm Hulk Hogan or anything, but it's a nice thing. And if we can do it, just to let everybody know that we're behind whoever's got to do this and wipe out this monstrosity, you got to be kidding me. Come on, let's get behind it and let's do it.
All right, thanks a lot, Steve.
You got it, Ronnie, baby.
There you go, Steve. Yeah, Kurt Angle's going to be very popular.
Here's Anthony. Anthony, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, guys, what's up?
Yeah. Hey, Anthony.
Yeah, I work over at JFK Airport, and I've seen the security over there, and it is definitely not sufficient enough.
What is the problem, in your opinion?
I mean, it's like a lot of people, honestly, and nothing against like the Indian race or anything, but I know a lot of them are my friends who come over from India and Pakistan and all these countries, and they just get these jobs for like $5.16 an hour, and they're the ones who are running the X-ray machines and all this other kind of stuff.
All right, Anthony, never in my life have I felt like, oh, I got away with something walking through the airport. Matter of fact, I've had a few people get busted that I know get busted for pot because they had something else in their bag. That's what happened to that guy from West Wing. He had a hash pipe in his bag.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, the next thing you know, he's being pulled in.
Aaron Sorkin, remember when the mad cow disease was going on?
Yeah.
Chuck Nice came in from overseas and ends up having to get his feet and his shoes sprayed.
Yeah.
Just for, you know, sick cows.
Well, I mean, it's definitely, it's up there. The security is good. I mean, they'll catch people, but if you need to get something through, there, I worked in a bag room, mm-hmm. and I work in cargo now. And even in regular shipments, there's easy ways to get things through.
All right, Anthony, I'm sure after today, everything will be looked at. By the way, though, while we're talking about that, think of how many times you go through the airports and you're mad at those people. You're angry with those people for one reason or another. What the hell is this? Now on a day today, everybody's ready to blame everybody else. But think of how many times in your own life you're acting like, what are you, nuts?
Yeah. I think Patrick Kennedy headbutted one of them one time.
Yeah, I mean, the whole thing about people flipping out, that whole air rage thing, has been going on the last couple of years since they added all this extra security.
But the incomprehensible thing of at least four people got on four jet airliners and took out four captains, four crews. That's amazing. That's staggering to think that that can happen.
Dolores, you're on the Ron Fez show.
Hey,
Dolores.
New Jersey. I'm watching television on MSNBC. They're saying that they think at least half the firemen that responded are probably dead. Whole companies are missing. And they had a number of, like, at least 200.
Oh, God.
I was watching it all day. I watched them, but I'm really upset. But I agree with that guy with the flag. My flag's out there all the time.
Yeah.
Dolores, MSNBC just said this, huh?
Yeah. They had a little bit with the people in Congress talking, you know, and I got your show on and the television and,
right.
You know, during that, they have all this stuff, like, running across the bottom of the screen.
All right.
So there's an awful lot of those guys out there that are buried underneath it. That, yes, there's over 200 firefighters may be dead.
All right, thank you very much, Dolores.
The people responding, one tower went, and then the next one went.
I don't want to, you know, be a part of any rumor mongering or scare anybody who's got family there.
Yeah.
I'm a little bit hesitant to get into that kind of stuff, Fezzy, but I'm also terrified to see what the numbers are going to look like when we're at the end of this.
Yeah, when they finally are able to get in there and the fires are out.
Yeah.
Because that building came, both those buildings came down, and it was weird because they said that you could see, like, the metal structure, like the skeleton to it. And everything kind of fell off of that, and then the whole structure came down.
It's gone. I mean, if you think of how many times the World Trade Center is in every picture of this this city, the logos and stuff, and that skyline is forever changed now.
When I finally caught the train on the way in here, I'm just reading the ads on the subway train in the car. And it's like, I look up at one, it says there's a big bike-a-thon coming up Sunday, September 23rd, starts and finishes at the World Trade Center.
Yeah, I guess.
And it's just, you know, it's everywhere in this city.
Mm-hmm. Well, and
now it's gone.
People that, you know, live here, grew up here, have no idea that people all over the world know that building. And when someone goes in New York, they'll say to them, did you go up to the top of the World Trade Center?
Right.
Oh, we, you know, we took these pictures. I mean, it's like 15 bucks.
I've taken my family up there. We've been out on the observation deck.
Yeah. Hey, Maurice, you're on Ron Fez.
Hey, Maurice.
Hey, guys.
Hey, buddy.
Go ahead, Maurice.
Did you guys hear that one of the planes was hijacked by these two guys with knives and box cutters?
No, I haven't heard that.
I can't understand how you could take over an entire plane with just knives.
But, you know, the other strange thing is to get a knife on would be as tough to get a, or box cutter on.
Right.
It's as tough to get a gun on, supposedly. Yeah. All right, thanks, Maurice.
See
I remember one very, very stupid incident. We had done a gig, Ronnie. We did a wrestling gig.
Yeah.
And it was a situation where we had to have the gimmick cane.
Right.
That was going to break over somebody. Well, I had forgotten and kept a little handsaw in my luggage that we use to cut through the cane. And I had a little stupid handsaw in my bag.
Right.
Oh, my gosh, I got stopped, you know, because it went through the x-ray machine. They saw it. They stopped. They opened the bag. They pulled it out. I forgot it was in there. I got pulled, you know, I got taken aside. I had to talk to security. So, yeah, like you're saying, a knife isn't going on any easier than the gun.
You know, I hear these people saying that security is lax, and, you know, to me, it never has been, Fuss. To me, it always seems like it's pretty tense.
Yeah.
I never even relax in an airport anymore. And I always think, do I have anything on me that I can't empty my pockets for?
And I'm always thinking, oh, this is great. I'm going to have to pull out my big, fat underwear in front of everybody.
Here from RonFez.net, Fez, he is the Rooster. He calls our show a lot. Rooster, you're on Ron and Fez. How you doing, buddy?
How's it going, guys?
Hey, man.
Hey, Rooster.
I was standing right on Church Street right in front of the building today when the second plane hit.
Yeah.
And I've been in the military a while, and I'll tell you, that's the most horrific thing I've ever seen. And I'm up in Connecticut now, and the units up here are on high alert, and we already got helicopters and soldiers, and we're probably all going to get deployed down to New York City. And I just ask that you guys help us out, and the viewers that are there that are in New York, please, if you see us there and you have a chance to give blood and you have a chance to lend a hand, do that. And it's a sad state.
Well, what's the talk about with most of the guys in the military? Who do they think is behind it? What's the feeling of what's next, Rooster?
Well, I'm really not sure what's next. I don't know if you guys saw this. There's all kinds of explosions in Kabul, Afghanistan right now where the Taliban is.
Right, but the word we hear is that's not us.
Yeah, a group called the Northern Alliance Rebels was taking credit for the Kabul bombing.
I tell you what, those things look a hell of a lot like cruise missiles
that are
in there. But
well, as far as I know, no official word out of our government what we're doing. And a lot of times if we do something like this, we'll hit first before we say anything, Fez.
Right, yeah, and maybe President Bush will have more details on that.
Yeah.
He speaks in 45 minutes.
Well, guys, I appreciate it, and for all listeners, please, God bless America, and support anyone that's out there, and thank you for all your help.
And Rooster, you know, keep in touch with us, all right, buddy?
I will.
All right, that's it.
Thanks, guys.
All right, this situation here, here's an update for people traveling on the LIR. As of 7:30... the Long Island Railroad will begin to run its regular weekday schedule. So that started about 15 minutes ago, according to this. Tomorrow, Wednesday, the Long Island Railroad anticipates running its regular weekday schedule. So that should be back
nothing
to normal.
Nothing changes there. Right. I don't know whether... I know they're saying they don't want anybody really downtown tomorrow, Fez.
Yeah.
And I don't know whether a lot of businesses will be closed in Manhattan. I would imagine a lot of them would be. It was very strange. I'll never forget the feeling that I felt on the streets today in Manhattan. It was the strangest thing ever. There was a feeling of fear, a feeling of shock. And people just looked like their hearts were broke.
And about the only traffic I really saw from where I could see is ambulances, police cars, fire trucks. Just a nonstop flow of sirens all day long.
Hey, Mike, you're on the Ron and Fez show. How you doing, buddy?
Yeah, Ron and Fez, how you doing?
Hey, man.
Hey, Mike.
I'm doing pretty good, but the thing is that the more I read about it, the less I can't believe that the towers are gone, man.
Yes, they are.
I mean, it's just a landmark, not only for New York, for the whole country.
Yes, it is. I mean, that's exactly why they went after him, Mike. That's exactly why they went after him, to give us this feeling after the fact.
Yeah, and I mean, it's right. I can see New York City from my window right now, and it looks so weird not to look at the Twin Towers.
I know, it's very odd. I just looked up and saw a picture of the night skyline.
Yeah, but...
With all the lights on and all the buildings.
And the towers
are
not
there. There's this huge black hole in the middle of all of it.
Yeah, it just looks really, really weird.
And that's something that you've seen on every news program every night.
Or when you watch movies from the 50s, doesn't it always look weird when they show the skyline? It looks so much smaller without the towers there.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I woke up at 10 in the morning, and my family was telling me, have you seen the news? I'm like, no, why, what happened? And my cousin told me, well, the Twin Towers fell down. Yeah. And I thought he was joking. I'm like, how in the hell are the Twin Towers going to fall down?
I know, it's so odd. It's like if you lived in Colorado and looked up and a mountain was missing.
Yeah,
yeah, just like that, exactly.
You know, or like if you looked up in the sky and where's the moon?
Yeah.
Yeah,
now, I think I was listening to Donna Mike, and it was kind of why all this was on, and I think Don Geronimo was saying, well, we better get people out of the arch in, you know, St. Louis.
Yeah.
We better get people off the Golden Gate Bridge, out of this, you know, away from the Space Needle. That's the feeling that we had at the time.
Yeah, all day long, you never had the feeling that the attacks were over.
Yeah.
That the danger had passed. And with both Twin Towers out, you knew the Empire State Building was next.
Yeah, I was just waiting for the next plane to just crash in the Empire State Building. Yeah. I was just waiting for that.
All right, but that didn't happen. All right, thank you, Mike.
Okay, later.
All right, it's 877-692-1027. What a day. It is the Ron and Fez show, kind of a different show tonight. We thought we'd just... you know, we're not going to be reporting as much news as the other stations. If you're looking for the news, we recommend 1010 Wins.
Yeah.
Also, you know, everything on TV has the pictures. Those pictures are going to stay with us the rest of our lives.
Yeah. And, of course, you know, by this time of day, there's every angle, an amateur video, too, of the Twin Towers being attacked. Of course, if you just want to let us know how you made it through the day, you can give us a call here, 877-692-1027.
Tommy, you're on Ron and Fez.
Good evening, boys. How are you?
Good.
It was weird today. I mean, in a nutshell, I'm not going to ramble on, but, I mean, a few things really got me. But the one thing that really, really got me, I was a block away watching this whole thing. It was just so friggin' surreal. I still can't even believe it. But there was a couple, obviously... very high up, they had nowhere to go, and they basically just took each other's hand and just jumped off, and, you know, that was really just, to me, just blew my mind.
You were down there at the time, Tommy?
Yeah, I went to make up a cooking class today, matter of fact, so the first plane hit while our bus was still in the tunnel. When we heard on the radio that a plane hit one of the towers, we thought a helicopter or a plane wing clipped it.
Right.
There really was
yeah.
no detail. Then about 10 seconds later, I switched to 1010 Wins, and they just started just giving all this information. So by the time we pulled out of the tunnel, still only one tower was hit. So we were stuck right at that turn, just to turn off into Battery Park and, you know, go around. We were waiting at a light. All of a sudden, we just heard the engines, like, roaring real loud. And then, boom, the whole area just shook. That's when guy kicked the bus window out, getting people out, and that's when that area was just in complete mayhem.
Sure.
It was out of a movie. It really was out of a movie.
Yeah.
Well, thank God you guys are all right, and obey the D.
All right.
The story got weirder and more surreal as it went along. You hear that a plane went into the World Trade Center.
Yeah.
Then you find out it's a terrorist attack on the World Trade Center. Then you find out they used one of our own commercial airliners to do this. It got weirder as it went.
It's an amazing, amazing story. Our city attack. And the latest word is, and the young lady called with it earlier, and now we're getting those reports across all the news, that they're saying at least 200 firefighters presumed dead at the scene of the bombing. 200. Mm-hmm. Unbelievable. We've talked about this on our show many times over situations. I mean, remember how our hearts broke in that story in Queens when all those firefighters died.
Right, when that building collapsed during that fire.
And now we're looking at least 200 here.
Right, yeah. 200 firefighters who responded to the call for help, tried to get there to help out anyone that was hurt when the planes crashed into the buildings. Then those buildings themselves just collapsed on top of everybody.
Hey, Mike, you're on Ron and Fez.
Yeah. Update that. I'm watching Fox News. It says 250 firefighters and 200 police are missing.
It's unbelievable. And the horrible thing about it is you can only expect the numbers to go up from this point.
Oh, God. Just going
to
keep...
It's disgusting. It makes you sick to your stomach.
Sure does.
Yeah,
and it adds to the just, you know, everyone's still in that shock state, that area of denial. Can this really be happening? And this just adds to that.
As I heard about it this morning, I came upstairs to check it out. I actually saw the second one come down.
Yeah.
They go to street view, and then you hear everybody going, go, go, it's going. Then they pan up, and you just see it collapse. Bang. That was
there, it. There is amazing footage that television has now. You know, the other strange thing, we were talking about how you have that am I watching a movie feeling. And I guess a lot of us haven't been, you know, in this type of situation, but maybe it's just a defense mechanism that we take on, that this cannot be real. This cannot be happening.
And there's just always this thing of you just don't want it to be as bad as it looks.
Right.
And maybe they're, you know, oh, God, but, you know, it's just not.
Like O&A were saying, they were watching and they were saying, no, stay up, stay up.
Right, yeah.
Trying to will it to stay up.
That's something, Mike, because you're watching it and you see the hole in the one building and you think, well, that's going to be a mess for a while, but that can be fixed.
Yep.
Then you see the other one attacked. And you think, all right, they're still there. You lose one, and it's like, oh, my gosh, we're down to one World Trade Center. Then the whole thing's just gone.
And then the other building, too, number 7.
World Trade Center number 7 also collapsed.
47 stories up itself.
Yeah. Right, that would be a gigantic story on any news day.
Right.
And at the very most, now that one just seems like a footnote to this, 47 stories. Most cities in the country don't have one building 47 stories tall.
Right, and if they do, that's their skyline. That's
it. Right. So, Mike, you said the last thing you heard, 250 firefighters and 200 policemen missing.
Yeah. That's all I didn't say. Nope. Just said missing.
So missing could mean a million things, and we know that they're running around doing everything.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much. I mean, if you are the type of person who prays, pray for them and their family, because it's the strangest thing, Fez. The guys in that line of work, when other people are running away, they're running towards it.
Yeah.
And
they do have the toll-free number set up for information on victims' families and survivors. That phone number, 1-800-331-0075.
1-800-331-0075. Now, don't tie that line up with a bunch of, you know, questions for them and stuff. If you have a specific person you're looking for, call with that.
Yeah.
But, you know, don't be curious with that line if you've got no business with it. Tom, you're on Ron Fez.
Hey, Tom.
Hey, what's up, Ron? What's up, Fez?
Yeah.
I just want to say, you know, I've been listening to you guys since the very beginning, and you guys are a real class act, the way the way you're handling this whole thing, and, you know, not brown notes or anything. You guys really are. You handle this like men. It's almost like therapeutic in a sense, because you guys are, you know, you let everybody vent on how they feel. You know,
all right, well, let's let some of those calls through, okay, Tom?
All right, man, be good.
See you, buddy.
Tom. Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, there's wins if you need your information, and, of course, every TV station has footage, but you're not allowed to call those places. You can call here.
877-692-1027. Hey, Chris, you're on Ron Fez.
Yeah, speaking of all the other news stations, I heard on CNN that the reservoir upstate is being surrounded by military. They're afraid of somebody contaminating the drinking water that comes to New York City.
Is that right?
Yeah, it's unbelievable. This was a devastating thing. I was actually across the East River watching it in Greenpoint, Brooklyn.
Yeah.
It's like exactly across the East River from the Twin Towers. And I work in a trucking company, and I load trucks all day.
Right.
And we were there on the pier, and I'm telling you, I never even could imagine such devastation. Chills ran through me. I got sick to my stomach. I think I've had diarrhea since then, the entire day. No kidding.
You know what? I got that too, Chris.
Did you?
I thought it was just my diet.
That's what I was thinking, but I really feel upset about it, and the hair on my arm stands up every time somebody gives out their condolences, and I hear about all the firefighters and the brave police that went right into that building.
At this point, it is impossible to think about all the people that are going to be affected by this. It's literally too much.
I have an aunt who works in the tower that fell first. She works on the 97th floor. She's supposed to be in at 9 a.m.
Yeah.
She was late for work today. When she got out of the subway, the devastation had already been taking place. She had no idea.
Oh, my gosh.
Her whole company was in work, and she must have lost like 50, you know,
sure,
that she works, but she hasn't heard a word about it. And I'd like to just mention that everybody in the New York area who had got hit by some of the rubble or maybe even the ashes fell on them, asbestos is in the air. Put your clothes inside of plastic bags. Have yourself washed thoroughly and definitely see a doctor and get some results from your clothes being examined for asbestosis poisoning.
All right, thanks a lot, Chris. Appreciate it, buddy.
Hey, I love
Chris.
You guys.
Right, thanks.
Love.
Yeah, that dust cloud is amazing. That's the sort of thing you see on TV where they do like in a movie when an atomic bomb goes off. There's that cloud and all that dust.
Here's Melissa. Melissa, you're on Runafest.
Hey, Melissa.
Hi, you guys. Hi, how are you?
Yeah.
I just want to let everybody know I work in New Jersey, a little bit further away, and we're starting to get people in by train into Morristown, and then our ambulances are picking them up and bringing them into the hospital. They're not as critical as ones in the city, but, you know, we are being affected here in New Jersey, so we're looking for volunteers. Our blood banks are open. There was hundreds of people there today. There's also local blood banks in the area. You know, we'll take any donation, any volunteers. The nurses, you know, are working overtime. Doctors, residents are really putting in a hard day's work and what's to come. Actually, this is just the start of it. Tonight, tomorrow, and, you know, the next couple of days are where it's going to get worse.
Yes, I'm afraid that you're right. Here is one of the things they're asking for. A blood donation type O is needed.
Yeah, that O is the universal donor. It can go to anybody that needs blood. So people that have O are really encouraged to get out there. And this is your way to, you know, give back to your country because there are people that need it. We're already in a shortage. So this could really help. You know, indirectly, without having to be in the city, this can help get to the city.
Okay, thank you very much. Here's the number for that. If you have type O blood, 1-800-HELP-NOW, 1-800-HELP-NOW, or 1-800-933-BLOOD. Those two numbers, Fez, 1-800-933-BLOOD, 1-800-HELP-NOW.
All right, if you're able to donate, you might want to look into that and those phone numbers. Our phone number, 877-692-1027.
Coming up in a half an hour, we will cut away for the President of the United States for the first major speech of his administration and probably, you know, the most important speech any president's made in quite some time, Fez.
Yeah, he spoke initially in Sarasota, Florida before he left that classroom. Then he pre-recorded a statement when he was in Louisiana.
Yeah.
From there, he went on to Omaha, Nebraska. That's where it gets weird, where it's like, if you think of this as a situation of war, our president can't return to the Capitol. It's like our leader is on the run.
Yeah, and it was very, very strange to hear him say right off the bat, I want to thank everybody here at the, whatever it was, elementary school.
Right,
and
yeah.
And standing like in a classroom.
And it was odd. He had all these little kids around
him. Right, because he was planning on doing something about reading or something.
He's pushing his education plan, and he's been going to schools and reading to them. And so I guess that was the situation. I guess he read to the kids, finished that, then made his statement and took off immediately.
So it'll be very, very interesting what he has to say tonight. And coming up in under a half an hour, here is Oscar. Oscar, you're on Runafest.
Hey, what's up, boys?
Hey.
Hey, yeah, Ronnie. CNN has Senator Clinton on.
All right, let's kind of wait for that then. Hold on.
Earl, can you bring up CNN in here for me, Benny?
We're going to cut away. Fez wants to hear what the New York Senator Clinton has to say.
We're all united behind the president. We are,
as you
saw earlier, with the legislative leadership of our country from both houses of Congress on both sides of the aisle, saying just as clearly as we can that this was an attack on America, and the president of the United States is our president, and we will support him in whatever steps he deems necessary to take, both in the retaliation that will be called for, and also in the very important work of rebuilding New York and the Pentagon. We can't let these evil acts in any way deter us from, you know, making it clear that the United States is resolute and we are going to support the president.
And are you getting any new information from law enforcement out of New York about just the extent of the loss in New York?
John, I don't think we even have an inkling of the devastation. We've not really had the kind of coverage at Ground Zero that would show what I'm hearing. You know, rubble sometimes up to your waist. Our firemen and police officers wading through dangerous circumstances trying to see if there are any survivors. The numbers of people who are injured and who we fear are casualties, I think will be terrible once they are fully understood. I'm very proud of New York City. The mayor, the police, the fire, all the people working in the emergency front lines have done a superb job. But, you know, New York is the global city. It's the symbol of American leadership. And, you know, these terrorists made a direct hit on who we are as a people. And New York has responded, and the national government has to stand behind us.
And, Senator, you had told us earlier that you had spoken at length with the former president, your husband. What is Mr. Clinton saying?
Well, he's outraged and, you know, deeply angry, as I think all of us are, but is absolutely behind whatever this administration chooses to do, because he knows how important it is to speak with one voice on behalf of our country. This is something that he and I believe strongly, having been on the other end of Pennsylvania Avenue. You know, and let me say, too, that our country not only has to retaliate directly against those who perpetrated this attack, but we have to make it very clear that we cannot permit any state, any government, any institution or individual to pursue terrorist aims that are directed at the United States or any country with impunity. So I'm hoping that this is the kind of dramatic, terrible catastrophe that unites the entire civilized world, so that it's not just an attack on the United States. It's an attack on everyone who cares about, you know, freedom and dignity and justice and humanity.
Now, we're told that the Congress has never been evacuated before, not during the War of 1812, not during the Civil War. This was an extraordinary day. Of course, you are coming back. We had the display of unity on the steps of the Capitol. But is any business really going to be able to be done here? I mean, we've entered a new phase here, haven't we?
I don't think so, John. I think that clearly, because of the uncertainty that surrounded first the attacks in New York and then the attack on the Pentagon, it was prudent for these buildings to be evacuated, and I certainly went along with that, as did my staff. I think, though, tomorrow you'll see that, you know, the Senate and the House will be back in session. We will be debating a resolution that really expresses our very strong feelings of outrage about this. And then we're going to be getting down to the hard work of determining what we need to do. I've, you know, told my colleagues that this is the kind of devastating attack and loss of life that is almost beyond imagination.
All right, that's Senator Clinton speaking on today's terrorist attacks on America.
Very bipartisan, Fezzi, is I think Everybody's going to be feeling tomorrow.
Yeah.
You know, whether you voted for George W. Bush or whether you didn't, and or whether you didn't vote at all, which is most people.
Sure.
This is your guy right now. This is your guy. And not saying you got to vote for him again in 3 years.
Right.
But right now, this country... And it's incredible to say, because sometime you're saying, okay, it was a terrorist attack, whatever you call it. This was an attack, period.
Yeah.
Like, we've never seen before, not only on this country, but on our city.
Like, came up there, Congress has never had to been evacuated before in the history of this nation.
And it was the only thing to do, because we didn't know where they were heading next.
Yeah. You didn't know if another jet airliner was going to end up going into the Capitol building.
Hey, Angelo. Angelo, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, Angelo.
Hey, guys. Yeah. You know, sad day for the world, sad day for New York City.
Yeah.
What gets me is just how detailed and how well planned out this attack was.
Yes, it was.
You know, the planes are taking off minutes apart from each other from all these different locations. And they all head back in the same direction, just at different areas.
Right,
it's like, it's like they had months and months of planning to go at, and the government, you know, they mean to tell me that there's, you know, there's no way they could have found this out.
You know, I don't know all that. I know a lot of people are finger pointing for me, Angelo. I'm not quite at that point right now. you would hope that, you know, we would have been able to stop this. Obviously, we didn't. I don't know how much you can stop out there. It seems very, very strange that they were able to pull this off with, like you said. And also, it does seem like somebody with some money was behind this thing.
Yeah, so well coordinated. Like you said, the timing of just having those particular planes and when they took off.
Especially with the World Trade Center. I mean, they're 18 minutes apart from different locations. And then, you know, half an hour later, they attacked the Pentagon.
You know, the second one that ran into the other Twin Tower, the Twin Tower that was hit second, that plane actually circled the World Trade Center
for 15 minutes.
Yeah, watching the first one make its attack and then put it right into the center of one of the Twin Towers.
Like as if it saw the first plane make the mistake of going to the top of the towers and going right into the center so it knew it would do a lot more damage.
I mean, that's amazing control for an aircraft that big.
Definitely, because they were, what, a 757 or a 767?
Right.
You know, those are not that big of planes compared to a 747, but they can carry enough passengers and do a lot of damage, plus the fact of how much fuel they were holding on to.
They
were long-term flights.
Yeah. Right, yeah, and they had just taken off. They're just full of fuel.
Well, yeah, when you have that Boston to L.A. thing, you're talking about tons of fuel.
Right.
They said the planes weighed about, like, close to 200 tons or something like that.
Yeah,
wow.
You know, so just the force alone knocked out. I mean, I work in downtown Brooklyn, and I saw the structures, you know, before the second plane hit. Once that second plane hit, all you can see was the beams on the corners of the building standing up.
Right.
That was it.
All right, thanks a lot, Angelo.
All right, guys.
Thanks, Angelo. Now, what we have here is a notice to parents. Some of the students from PS 234, they have been evacuated to PS 41. So students that are attending PS 234 have been evacuated to PS 41.
All right, is that kids that are staying there overnight that their parents couldn't get to them yet?
It sounds like, you know, when they wouldn't let the kids go without the parent or legal guardian, right, they've been locked down.
All right, so if you were going to pick up your kids at 234... over to PS 41.
All right, and PS 41 is located at 116 West 11th Street. That's off of 6th Avenue. The phone number there for PS 41, 212-675-2756.
Okay.
All right.
All right, another one of those, Fez, if your kid was in PS 150, they've been evacuated to PS 3, which is located at Christopher Street and Hudson Street.
Oh, okay.
And I'll give you that phone number, 212-691-1183. That's 212-691-1183. If your kid was at PS 150, they've evacuated them over to PS 3.
Right. And children from PSSIS 89 have been evacuated to either PS 3 or PS 41. So, a lot of numbers there. If you need any more of that information, we'll give it to you. Real quick here, students from PS 234 have been evacuated to PS 41. Students from PS 150 have been evacuated to PS 3. Children from PS Island 89 have been evacuated to either PS 3 or PS 41.
All right, we're going to take some calls here tonight. We're going to cut away, though, when the President of the United States comes on at about 8:30, Fez?
Yeah, 8:30, the President is expected to speak.
Now, how long he'll speak or what he'll have to say, I have no idea. I don't imagine it'll be much different from what you just heard from Senator Clinton, although I'm sure they've been working on this all day.
Yeah.
It'll be a very historic speech. I'm guessing, Fez, you don't back down.
No.
You don't back down, you don't surrender. I mean, what has happened today... horrible, terrible, but what else do you do but you go on?
Yeah, you keep it going, you keep it moving, and you're not going to lay down for these creeps that did this thing.
All right, here is Ann, you're on Ron and Fez. How you doing?
Hi, guys.
Hey.
Hi, Ann.
Listen, point I want to make is that plastic explosives are very easily gotten on planes.
Is that right?
Yes, absolutely. There is the only way to detect it right now is through bomb sniffing dogs, which they don't do, that can sniff explosives. So
uh-huh.
I'm sure that was on. And the other point is, I wanted to ask you guys, Why do you think, obviously this is Bin Laden because this is his stereotypical...
Well, we really don't know this yet. I mean, you're saying obviously.
Well, if you look at his profile, which I have actually and kind of studied it, it's very typical. So let me ask you this. Why do you think these attacks occurred?
Well, you tell me if you've studied this.
Well, no, I'm not. He has a very great anger toward the American people, and basically he equates us, and this is in an interview that he did in 97, and this is word for word verbatim, he equates us with that we do acts that most ravenous animals would not descend to. That's his own words. But basically, we are the terrorists of the world. So I want to know what your opinion is.
Thank you for calling in. I'm not going to sit here and debate this type of situation. Matter of fact, I look up, I see...
We're not a political show.
I see... Well, it's not even that, or if we were, Fezzy, it's not the time for this.
Right.
I see Skinhead John is up there, and he wants to talk about U.S. foreign policy and
that's
stuff
political.
Like that.
We're not going to do that.
Well, you know, I'm not even saying that we wouldn't be political, but I'm not going to sit there and talk this way when we've lost how many thousands... of our fellow New Yorkers.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about police. We're talking about firefighters. We're talking about EMTs. We're talking about people who are just going about their daily life that have nothing to do with any American foreign policy, Anne.
Right.
And I'm not going to sit here and debate you. Call over to one of the other shows where they like to sit and scream about this stuff all the time. We're sitting here tonight talking about our city that was attacked today.
And the disaster, and how you're feeling, not how you feel about foreign policy.
And you're not going to get to the bottom of it anyway, Anne, when you're just sitting there reading your little weird things on the internet.
No matter how much you studied.
877-692-1027. Hey, Keith, you're on Runifest.
Hi, Keith.
You tell him, Ronnie.
Yeah.
That's what I like to hear.
Yeah.
Now, I just like to say, out of all the million things that we could say today, first of all, my condolences to everyone in New York City. Now, as a fellow in New York City, I want everyone in New York to come together and to be strong. This is a time where we are all going to learn and we are all going to come together and make a new city. We are going to come together and we're going to destroy other worlds. This is a city of power, and we're all eclectic, and we can all come together and be strong about this.
Thanks a lot, Keith. All right, see you later.
No, he actually sounded like Bunny.
No. He's on his way. Don, you're on Runifest.
Hey, guys, how are you tonight?
Hey, buddy.
Hey, first of all, let me just simply say, during normal circumstances, I think you guys are the funniest guys on New York radio. But I did want to say, I mean, despite what Anne was talking about politically, how incredibly catty was that they showed Palestinians dancing in the street?
Yeah, they showed those kids out there, and those kids have no idea what the hell they're doing. They have no idea what the situation is.
I just thought that was just incredibly tacky, and I was thinking, well, they were talking about wanting to find someone. I say, hey, there's the first place to look if these people are all up in arms about it. But even then, if you don't like a country, come on. I mean, why be catty about it? I mean, it wasn't just the kids. I mean, like, these were the adults. They were, like, flashing victory signs, and everybody was just all thrilled about that, and I just thought that was just really sad.
Well, you know, and it's a... You know, I'm sure John is correct. I'm sure Anne is correct that this country is hated somewhere in the world from time to time by, you know, sometimes huge groups of people, sometimes, you know, small groups. But this is something, you know, if somebody attacked anywhere like this today, I think we'd all feel bad.
Right, yeah.
You know, I think that we would all be against this if we saw Moscow getting attacked like this today.
And we don't dance here.
And we're looking at the people who have lost their lives in this, and the thousands and thousands of families, Fezzy, who now their lives will change forever.
Yeah.
Family lives.
Yeah.
Family histories are now forever changed.
Yeah, it's the whole thing is just really sad, and especially I'm like, all the New York cops out there, I mean, they've taken a lot of fire. this year for lots of different things. But this is when they're really shining, is at times like this. And I'm really proud. One of, friend of mine is a New York City cop, and I was never more proud of him today than I was any other day. Just him running in there and just playing the hero like that.
It's amazing stuff, Don. All right, thanks a lot, buddy.
Thank you very much. Have a nice night, guys.
Ron and Fez, Don. Staying on the air with you tonight, just taking some phone calls. We've said it before, if you're looking for news, there's much better places to get it. Go to 1010 Wins.
Right.
Also, the stuff on TV tonight is it's just heartbreaking.
Yeah, the footage still as shocking as seeing it live.
And the report's coming in. Heartbreaking, Fez.
Yeah.
You know, we're hearing the amount of New York City firefighters that we've lost today, New York City police officers that we lost today, unprecedented.
Yeah, exactly. What's presumed at this point is we've heard as many as 250 firefighters missing, 200 police officers missing.
And, you know, I just want to point out to Ann and John, the skinhead they called, and people like that that want to talk political stuff. There will be time for that, but tonight is not that time, at least not for me. And what can I say? The show's half named after me, Fez.
Right.
But the situation is, you're talking to a city right now that is literally in shock. We are not at the point where we can figure out what foreign policy changes we have to make. Our neighbors lost their lives today.
This in, the fire from when the Pentagon was attacked today, that is finally under control. So after going on all day long.
There's a situation, Fuzzy. That Pentagon story would have been probably the story of the year.
Right.
If New York City wasn't attacked.
The Pentagon was actually attacked about 9:40 this morning.
And the situation what happened with the...
it was the third attack.
The plane in Pennsylvania.
Right.
That was heading and what happened to it.
Yeah, that was United Airlines Flight 93, a Boeing 757 en route from Newark to San Francisco. That plane was carrying 38 passengers, two pilots, and five flight attendants. It crashed southeast of Pittsburgh around 10 a.m.
So coming up within 10 minutes, we're going to break away as the President of the United States will talk to the people of America and the people of the world, Fezzy, which is going to be the speech of his lifetime.
Yeah, we'll bring that live to you right here.
And, of course, it'll be on every TV channel that you can imagine. And after that, I believe the Democrats will have something to say, which is basically going to be, we support the president 100%.
Sure.
I don't know if he's going to give us any details on what what is happening. What he plans to do. Of course, a lot of people want some type of retaliation to take place.
Sure. People already looking for revenge when we're not definite who to be revengeful against.
Well, I have no idea right now what they know.
Yeah.
You know, maybe they know exactly who it is. Maybe they don't. They haven't released, or as far as we know, nobody has taken responsibility for this attack. But for us, no matter what the president has to say, we lost so many souls today in New York City.
Yeah. He'll definitely send out his condolences and try to unite the country. 877-692-1027. We'll take your phone calls on how you feel about everything that transpired today. And, of course, after the president speaks, we'll continue to take those phone calls.
Mike, you're on Ron and Fez.
Yeah, what's up, Ron and Fez?
Hey, buddy.
I'm real sorry. I forgot what I was going to say.
That's all right, pal.
I was just thinking about other stuff. But when I was online, I was thinking, you know, today, one of the few good things that came out of today is that I'm no longer black. I'm no longer Haitian. You're no longer white. We're all just Americans today. And it's like us versus them, even though we don't know who they are, you know?
Yeah.
You know, and we live in such an international city, Fezzy. There are so many people. I guarantee you that there's not an ethnic group that did not lose somebody today. That there, it was a tough day for everybody who lives in New York. And it was probably the most international city in the world right now. We've got people from all over here.
Right. I know when I was, you know, walking down the street in my neighborhood to, you know, get a closer look at what was going on, there's people that I probably pass on that street constantly.
Yeah.
You know, for months, and, you know, don't even look at or smile to, and people just gather together, just talking to each other today.
Sure.
Everybody out there just all feeling the same way.
All right, thanks.
Lousy.
Yeah, Mike.
I really respect you guys. I respect everybody at WNEW for what they've done today, you know?
Well, we've done nothing. Thanks a lot, though, Mikey. Sid. All we've done
and
is
we hope to do more of it.
All we've done is a radio show, and the real people, to respect to the people who, as people were running away from those explosions, with the people that were running at it, the EMT workers, the firefighters, the New York City police, and countless, Fezzy, acts of heroism that took place today.
Sure. Everyday people that got caught in that situation and did something to try to help. And some of those stories that are coming out, amazing.
Yeah. Hey, coming up in just a few moments, we're going to keep an eye on this, Fezzy. I want us to cut away right before the president comes on. Abby, you're on Ron and Fez. Hey, Abby.
Hi, guys. Hey, listen, I just want to say, well, one, thank you for being on. But the other thing is, you know what I'm going to do is my grandfather served in World War II, and when he was buried, they gave him a 21-gun salute and buried him with the American flag and gave me the flag. I'll be flying that.
All right, where are you calling from, Abby?
Thank you. Right, bye-bye. New Jersey.
New Jersey, okay. Right, thanks a lot.
Thanks, Abby.
What a day, Fezzy.
Yeah.
Here's Mike. Mike, you're on the Ron and Fez show. Hi, Mike. By the way, we'll leave these phone lines open, 877-692-1027. Yeah, Mike.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about the radar. You know, the planes are on radar, right?
Yeah.
They showed on the TV, they have the path of the planes leaving from Boston.
Yeah,
right.
When the plane takes a hard left off course, doesn't the guy on the radar know, like, something's wrong?
Well, quite frankly, Mike, I'm sure that they were following along and probably talking to him up to that point. We have no idea what was being said, you know, and maybe even at some point they realized that they had somebody take over that aircraft. But I don't think that they knew that, you know, it was going to kamikaze.
Yeah, and then when it gets to New York, though, New York is all closed airspace.
Yeah.
You get close to New York City without having a pass to be there.
Right.
They should know, you know. That kind of puzzles me. I mean,
I'm sure all these details are going to come out over the next weeks.
Yep.
All right.
It's good. And like that last lady said, thanks for being on.
All right. Thank you,
Mike. It's good to have regular people talking about this, not just the news and all that. So
well, I mean, that's literally the only thing that we can do here. If you're looking for news,
that's it.
You know, worst
like
place
say,
to go.
You know, the rest of us regular folks, we want to listen to something regular, too, you know?
All right. Thanks, Mikey.
And also, you're giving out all those phone numbers, emergency, this and that.
Yeah.
Sorry to lighten up the situation, but being that all those cops died, maybe they got a few openings, and you might need to make a few calls for them. There's job openings, you know?
We'll look at that later, Mike. Thanks.
All right.
All right.
All right, the emergency number again, the toll-free number for any information for victims' families, to check on survivors, 1-800-331-0075.
That is the number for that. Also, Fezzy, we'll have some more numbers for people that have type O negative blood. As a matter of fact, all the New Yorkers should be given blood this week.
I have no idea what my type is.
No, me neither. Type O negative seems to be the important one.
Yeah, as one lady told us, that's the one that everybody can get. It's compatible with everyone's blood type.
Which I had no idea about that, by the way.
I didn't know that either.
Billy Staples is type O negative.
That figures.
No, just type O.
It gets along with everybody.
All right, here it is. Blood donation type O needed. Call for a location close to you. 1-800-HELP-NOW. 1-800-HELP-NOW. Or 1-800-933-BLOOD. 1-800-933-BLOOD. Coming up in just a minute or two, the President of the United States.
Yeah, looking up at the monitor, I haven't seen anyone cut away
right
to that podium or anything, or to the Oval Office.
But that's supposed to go down at 8:30 exactly, Fez?
Right, that's the word we've been given. We'll keep a check on that, and Hawk and Billy Staples and Earl. If you'll please keep checking on that, too, we'd appreciate it.
We'll let that play in its entirety and maybe even some of the stuff that they have to say afterwards, because I have no idea, Fizzy, if he's going to run for 5 minutes or, you know, a half an hour.
Yeah.
So we'll keep an eye on that, and then we'll come back on the air with you.
So, Billy, if you could check with Black Earl and just make sure that I'm supposed to go to Wins for the president's speech. I'm sure Wins has it.
Right.
But just, you know, make sure I'm pushing the right button in here.
Yeah. Don't let...
You're a big Earl. That man always screams before the door is completely shut.
All
Can
you...
I go to Wins for President Bush's speech?
You go to either one.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
I'm sure there won't be a place in America, Fezzi.
Yeah.
I'm sure
that
Nick,
doesn't happen.
I'm sure Nick and Knight will cut away for the presidential speech tonight.
I don't know. It's Three's Company, Henry Allison.
The, you know, the funny thing is Billy came in and handed me two different papers with exact opposite information on them.
Really?
Yeah.
All right. Here's something that's unconfirmed, and then further unconfirms it.
And here's something on the other side. Please announce them both.
That way we've got everything covered.
Billy came in from Long Island today, one of the few people who could make it into the city from Long Island. We can't tell you how he got here.
That's a story in itself.
Yeah, that is a story in itself.
But I'll tell you what, he got the attention of the GM and the program director
here.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Billy actually looked like he had something on the ball today just for making it.
All right, we are about to cut away to the President of the United States. We'll be back after that to take your phone calls. And we'll hang out and just talk tonight, 877-692-1027. You're listening to Ron and Fez on 102.7 WNEW.
And we'll turn you over now to 1010 Wins.
And here now is President Bush reporting live from the White House. President Bush.
Today, our fellow citizens, our way of life, our very freedom came under attack in a series of deliberate and deadly terrorist acts. The victims were in airplanes or in their offices, secretaries, businessmen and women, military and federal workers, moms and dads, friends and neighbors. Thousands of lives were suddenly ended by evil, despicable acts of terror. The pictures of airplanes flying into buildings, fires burning, huge structures collapsing, have filled us with disbelief, terrible sadness, and a quiet, unyielding anger. These acts of mass murder were intended to frighten our nation into chaos and retreat. But they have failed. Our country is strong. A great people has been moved to defend a great nation. Terrorist attacks can shake the foundations of our biggest buildings, but they cannot touch the foundation of America. These acts shatter steel, but they cannot dent the steel of American resolve. America was targeted for attack because we're the brightest beacon for freedom and opportunity in the world, and no one will keep that light from shining. Today, our nation saw evil, the very worst of human nature. And we responded with the best of America, with the daring of our rescue workers, with the caring for strangers and neighbors who came to give blood and help in any way they could. Immediately following the first attack, I implemented our government's emergency response plans. Our military is powerful and it's prepared. Our emergency teams are working in New York City and Washington, D.C. to help with local rescue efforts. Our first priority is to get help to those who have been injured and to take every precaution to protect our citizens at home and around the world from further attacks. The functions of our government continue without interruption. Federal agencies in Washington, which had to be evacuated today, are reopening for essential personnel tonight and will be open for business tomorrow. Our financial institutions remain strong, and the American economy will be open for business as well. The search is underway for those who are behind these evil acts. I've directed the full resources of our intelligence and law enforcement communities to find those responsible and to bring them to justice. We will make no distinction between the terrorists who committed these acts and those who harbor them. I appreciate so very much the members of Congress who have joined me in strongly condemning these attacks. And on behalf of the American people, I thank the many world leaders who have called to offer their condolences and assistance. America and our friends and allies join with all those who want peace and security in the world. And we stand together to win the war against terrorism. Tonight I ask for your prayers for all those who grieve, for the children whose worlds have been shattered, for all whose sense of safety and security has been threatened. And I pray they will be comforted by a power greater than any of us, spoken through the ages in Psalm 23. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. This is a day when all Americans from every walk of life unite in our resolve for justice and peace. America has stood down enemies before, and we will do so this time. None of us will ever forget this day, yet we go forward to defend freedom and all that is good and just in our world. Thank you. Good night, and God bless America.
All right, that's 1010 Wins coverage of what went on today in New York City. And, of course, you heard President Bush's speech.
And also, if you're looking for news, we recommend that you go to 1010 Wins. We're going to give you occasional updates, but then basically here on the Ron Fez Show, just talk to people about what kind of day they had today.
Yeah, just a chance to talk it out. The terrible attack on New York City and, of course, Washington, D.C., and the whole country today.
All right, the president basically said, you know, the same thing that he said earlier today, Fezzy.
Right.
We won't back down and... we'll find the guys who did this and don't harbor them.
Yeah, exactly. Do a threat to any country that's going to be friendly to the terrorists. And his just general message of, yeah, you know what? The country's still working.
Yeah.
Don't worry. You know, the banks are sound and the financial institutions, the economy will continue.
I know.
We will get to business as usual.
I noticed that today you didn't have a lot of people bum rushing the ATM machines. I heard some stuff on the ONA show about people around the country jacking up gas prices, Fez. That's pretty shameful if that happens.
Yeah, really?
But I didn't see that myself.
No,
And we wanted to check in with people who are part of the WNEW extended family, people that you'll hear on our show or other shows. And I'm looking up on the line right here, Fezzy. It's Lady Di. Let's
Okay. Part of the retarded Laverne and Shirley.
All right. Let's see how Lady Di's doing. Lady Di, you're on Ron and Fez. How are you?
Hi, guys. How you doing?
Hi, Lady Di.
I saw the whole thing as it happened.
Where were you at?
I was at the brewery.
Uh-huh.
I was at Bud across the way. And you know what? Let me tell you something right now. It was very, very devastating.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It was unreal.
Lady Di, did you see the first plane hit?
Yes, I did.
Yeah.
I saw the first plane hit.
Yeah.
The second plane, I was at a meeting, so I didn't see that, but I heard the second building collapse. And can I just say one thing right now?
Sure.
Very, very emotional. It was... I can't explain it. It was just unreal. Unreal.
Yeah. I
cried all the way out of the building.
You went from drinking to a meeting?
No.
Well, she doesn't have brewery. She works there, right?
Oh.
No. I was working there. And it happened at 9 o'clock in the morning. Okay, what happened was I was on my first break at 9 o'clock in the morning.
Uh-huh.
And I saw when the first airplane came into the first building.
Right.
Okay, I saw that. Well, let's put it this way. Somebody told me that the first building exploded, everything like that. And then I went over and I saw, all right, this is what happened. I saw the first building just explode. The second one, I was at the meeting, and they said we can go whenever we want to go. But I'll tell you what right now, this was very emotional for me. I could not believe that this happened.
Yeah, Lady Di, it's one of those situations where, you know, so many times in your life you'll say, I'll never forget this as long as I live. Here's
you better
one day
believe it.
That you
I will never forget this as long as I live. I saw it on television so many times already.
And yeah. Lady Di, it's like you've had your best day and your worst day all in the same week with the MTV Video Music Awards.
Yeah, I know.
How long ago that feels now, though, doesn't it?
And then this?
Right.
You know what? Marion left for her vacation yesterday, okay, because her anniversary is today, as a matter of fact.
Is she flying?
Her wedding anniversary is today.
Was she flying?
Yeah, she was crying before.
I mean flying. Did she fly out?
Flying, not crying.
No, no. She was... Actually, she flew yesterday,
okay.
But she was crying today.
Yeah. All right.
He asked me
if I was okay yesterday, crying today, Ronnie.
I got you. All right, thanks so much, Lady Di. Bye, honey.
Guys.
All right.
We'll see you next time, okay?
Okay, bye.
All right. Lady Di, part of the retarded Laverne and Shirley from the ONA show.
So, you know, we just had them on the other night. We had so much fun with them.
Right.
It feels like a lifetime ago.
It really does.
It feels like a lifetime ago. 877-692-1027. It's the Ron Fez show. Here's Joe. Joe, you're on Ron Fez.
Hey, Joe.
Hi, guys.
Yeah.
Who is this robot we have that's the president? Did you hear the speech he read? No passion. I want to hear anger. We're all angry.
Well, I don't...
We're going to bang on the podium, and we're going to get these bastards.
Joe, that's probably one of the reasons why you're not president. I don't think... you know, he wants to direct us at a certain, you know... I mean, Fezzi, right now, I'm so numb, I don't know what that speech was about.
Sure.
You know?
And it was really short.
Yeah.
And
to me, he sounded like one of our phone callers.
Right.
You know, so...
This is like the one time I want Sharpton on my side, and I need his, you know, someone needs to light a fire up this guy's head.
You're angry.
Right. I'm angry. You know, everyone's angry.
You know, it's very, very understandable.
If you listen to President Roosevelt's Day in Infamy speech, it's not much more passionate.
Yeah, but I don't think anybody's going to quote anything from these, you know, from this speech.
Well, I don't know. I'm not ready to judge it yet, Joe. I'm sorry. Okay, buddy? All right, thanks.
Just angry, man.
All right.
Sure.
I understand that, and this is a place to express it.
Joe's moved into the anger stage.
Yeah. He's beating me there, Fess.
Yeah.
I am still somewhat... What are all those seven stages that you go through?
Is it denial? Is that the first one?
No, not denial. Well, maybe it's denial. Maybe denial and shock are somewhere along the line.
Right. Or maybe shock comes and then denial.
Yeah.
Because that's where I feel where I'm at.
Yeah.
Then there's... anger, bargaining, and acceptance.
I don't see bargaining being in there anymore.
A bargaining's going to be completely skipped.
Yeah. We'll leap over bargaining because, you know, it's way too late.
I think bargaining actually happened today when the Twin Towers were, you know, hit. And it's like you saw one go and you didn't want it to fall. You wanted these two buildings to stand up through this and then get fixed. And then you saw one go, and it's like, oh, please don't take the other one. And then that one went.
Here's Vanessa. Vanessa, you're on Rana Fest. How you doing?
Hi, Vanessa.
Hi. Hi, guys. What's going on?
Yeah.
I'm just calling because, you know, I live in a small town across the bridge in New Jersey, and it's like we used to go to this hill every year for the 4th of July because you could see the skyline beautiful.
Right.
You could see the fireworks. The sign of independence was in the sky. You know, it's like today you go there and you see a big cloud of smoke, something that to me made me feel like my independence has been threatened. And it's like, it's so emotional, you know, what's going on. Yeah, you know, I had family that were, you know, that worked in the Trade Center. You know, thank God my aunt's home safe, you know, but it's like you can't, it's like you go and you see, you know, you go to see the fireworks, and then it's like you go there on a tragic day like today, and you see how our independence has just totally been threatened, and how it's just the skyline looks so not like it always has for me. And I mean, that's just something that we used to do every year.
It is very, very sad that the skyline will be changed forever.
It makes you feel robbed.
No one
came and stole our skyline.
You know, I mean, I'm sure someday we'll have the, debate of whether we should rebuild there. Should we go build the biggest towers in the world? I mean, somewhere along the line, we have to say, you know, we're going to do what we do no matter what terrorists do out there.
Yeah.
You know, that we're not going to... we're not going to be dictated to.
We're not going to live in bunkers or go to work underground.
It is...
unless you're a miner.
It's shocking and sad when you're going to now notice how many times those towers are in pictures of the skylines. With the Met stuff and all when you're over there.
Sure.
Yeah, at the stadium.
It's in every logo.
Yeah.
And it's like people were there today taking pictures or were with their camcorders taking, you know, of something that's so horrendous and so devastating. It's like, how can you do that, you know?
Well, Vanessa, people do it in all different ways. You know, I'm not judging people for, you know, for the way.
No, I mean, I know. And I know that it was something that people wanted to see, you know, but it's like it's so close because it's across the water, across the bridge, in plain view. Where something so terrible had just happened, and people are just there with cameras.
All right, thanks, Vanessa.
Thanks a lot, guys.
That's Vanessa. That's how she feels. That's how she made it through her day. She went up on a hill in Jersey and looked at the skyline that now has a big hole in it filled with smoke.
That skyline that's going to be changed forever, Fez.
Yeah.
Luke, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, hi,
Luke.
Fez.
Hey, man.
First and foremost, I'd just like to give my respects to the NYPD and the Fire Department of New York for standing in the face of adversity. And basically today, you know, I've been sitting in class here about this, and the first thing that comes to my mind is, like, you know, this is it. Like, they're dropping a nuclear bomb, and I live in Connecticut, and that's just, you know, we're just done, you know, and everyone's basically going to die. So I go outside, I have a cigarette, and then I remember that Nostradamus had actually already predicted that this was going to happen.
You know, every time something comes down, somebody says Nostradamus predicted it after the fact. I mean, if there was ever a day not to believe that these psychics know a damn thing, Fuzzy.
Sure.
It was today.
Where's Madam Cleo letting us know this?
Yeah. Why hadn't one of them said, wait a minute, get out of New York today?
Right. Don't fly.
Hey, Bill, you're on Ron and Fez. How you doing, Bill?
Hi, Bill.
How you doing, Ron? How you doing, Fez?
Hey, buddy.
All right, I was there this morning. I delivered to a deli. I was actually talking to my friend. He was on the 110th floor. His name was Dean. I know he died. He's a very good friend of mine. I just want to put respect out to his family.
You were delivering to a deli at World Trade Center?
Across the street from the World Trade Center.
I see.
Okay. When I saw the first plane go through, and it was, you know, it's just incredible. And I sat there, and I saw the fire trucks and the ambulance and everything roll up, you know, and within 5 minutes, and you saw the other plane go through. And I'm trying to hold it together without swearing, guys. I'm sorry. Just to hear this, you know, I mean, I was trying to get through to Opie and Anthony, and I know I lost a best friend. I know, you know, they got to deal with this. Jesus Christ, I'm sorry.
I understand, Bill.
No, I just want to say, you know, if there's anybody out there, I mean, please help. I mean, really help. I mean, I got away just in time. Within 10 minutes, 15 minutes, I was down the street, and I heard the building go down. I took a couple people in the van. I looked behind me. I saw that building coming down.
Yeah.
And it was so destroyed, you know. I just wanted, you know, I'm just saying, you know, I was with the 82nd Airborne at the Marines, you know, out of Paris Island, and just I wanted to say, you know, if President Clinton, if you even hear this radio show, I'm willing to go over to Afghanistan. I got a bunch of friends. I'll take the mission.
Give me the
goddamn mission.
All right, thank you, Bill.
All right. I know he's very, very upset
that
President Clinton is no longer president.
This just in, President Clinton said, go ahead.
Now, toll-free phone number for information for the victims' families looking for survivors, 1-800-331-0075. That's 1-800-331-0075.
And please, if you happen to be, you know, part of the family or something there, please don't call that number just tying it up, asking about stuff. New York City schools, all New York City schools closed tomorrow, although they are expected to open on Thursday, Fez.
Okay. So nobody going to school tomorrow.
And, yeah, as a matter of fact, if you don't 100% have to be in the city tomorrow, do not come into the city.
Yeah. Because still a lot of things just not moving, and a lot of streets have to be shut down, and, of course, most of the downtown South Manhattan area.
Let me check with the Hawk. There's our man, the Hawk, who works with us here every night, Fuzzy. And we never really give him much props.
No,
The Hawk calls. I'd gotten over here today because I must have been here by 1.
Right.
Here at the radio station. The hall calls about 3 o'clock or so and says, I'm going to try to make it in. Where's he at? Come on in, Hawk.
Someone bring in the Hawk.
Maybe he went home early because he did get in here a little bit early. But I want him to, I haven't had a big chance to go over this story with him. Hey, Billy, is the Hawk out there? Could you write something to me?
And if he is out there, could you tell him to come in the studio, please?
All right, now I'm going to have to ask if Billy's out there.
Now we're not getting any word from Billy.
Yeah.
And I see Earl just flailing wildly.
All right, Earl, why are you flailing wildly?
What's funny is we're here to help you guys. Yeah. No matter what you need, just let us know.
All right, I'll just go back to the phones, Fuzzy. I wanted to hear his story, but that's okay. Hey, Tecumbo. Tecumbo, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, Tecumbo.
Hey, what's up, Ron and Fez?
Hey.
A lot of people are calling in tonight talking about how maybe Americans and New Yorkers should, like, feel good about how they responded to this and stuff like that. And I don't know. Just to me, it's not even time for that yet. I mean, this is a time for mourning. I'm just thinking about all day I've sat glued to the TV looking at tens of thousands of people that were killed in the most horrible of ways that I could even imagine. And I'm a 30-year-old man. I was just sitting here, not now, but early in the morning, I was just, like, crying.
Yeah.
Just thinking about these people are, you know, not just, I mean, forget the skyline being lost. I mean, these people were just killed. I mean, people who had lives, they had families, children, they were working hard. And just to be crushed and just horribly killed in this way. And I used to work at the World Financial Center. But underneath that whole complex, there's a whole other complex that has banks there and everything just underground, you know? Like
right, yeah, right.
You know, and all that, I don't know what happened. I haven't even heard a report on that yet.
I think that the reports of who is missing and who's gone to Combo is going to go on for weeks, my friend.
Yeah.
It's going to go on for weeks.
And then all those firefighters, and they were there just trying to help people.
Yeah.
And they were all up in the, you know.
I know exactly how you feel, my friend.
You know, I mean,
it's going to take what seems to forever to get those fires out and to get it safe to even move in there for more rescue workers to go in where it's already hazardous.
All right, Ron. Thanks a lot.
Okay, buddy.
Thanks, Tecumbo.
Tecumbo, I know exactly how you feel tonight, man. That these people who are our neighbors, Fez, and, you know, not to go back to some of the people who wanted to get political earlier, but how many of those people aren't involved in any kind of political stuff in the world? They're just trying to live their life.
All they did today was show up for work.
Yeah. For work, which in this city, you got to bust your ass just to slightly make it.
Right.
Just barely stay ahead of it.
Those people just showed up for work. There's people that boarded those planes today with no other intention than flying to the West Coast.
Hey, Hawk has come in here.
Oh, we found the Hawk.
Hawk, tell your story. You came over from Queens today and how you got here. Hawk is one of our producers on the show.
And my personal lackey.
Well, when I was, I called up the station and they said they were a little shorthanded. And I was like, can I come in? Can I help? And they said, yep. And at that time, none of the trains, none of the subways were working, and there was no buses. All the bridges and tunnels were shut down. So I just walked over to the Queensboro Bridge, 59th Street Bridge, walked over it, and walked across town to work.
Now, what was that like coming across the Queensboro Bridge? Was the bridge shut down on both sides? Nobody was driving?
No, there were two lanes open to driving coming out of Manhattan into Queens. But all the other lanes, there were about three, four, five other lanes. They were just people walking out of Manhattan.
Was traffic open on both levels?
I don't know. I was on the top level. But I'm not sure about the bottom. But
okay.
It was just people, just everyone sad and just walking past me going to Queens, and everyone was talking. A few people were on cell phones.
Did anyone try to stop you from going the wrong way? Like, you're going into Manhattan.
Right. No.
Did anyone try to say, hey, buddy, wrong way?
No, there was a handful of people actually going in my direction, too. There was a few people going into Manhattan, so no one was really... Everyone just seemed kind of dazed. They were just mainly just coming out of the city just for a look of...
I know. That was an amazing sight of just this never-ending trail of people... walking very slowly. I saw a couple people running to get across the bridge. But just a slow walk of people leaving a city that had been attacked.
Yeah. Once I even got into the city, the streets were just empty, too. No one was even... There were more people on the bridges, and the city was completely abandoned, it seemed.
How long do you think you took you to walk across that bridge?
About 20 minutes or so, more or less.
You know the other strange thing about today? Could we have had a more beautiful day in New York? It was the most gorgeous day of the year.
That sky was so blue.
It was hard to believe that all this tragedy was going on when it was just the most perfect day.
Yeah, there weren't any clouds or anything except for the smoke coming from the buildings.
Right, it was such a clear day that you could see the devastation from pretty much anywhere where you were at.
Hey, Casey, you're on Rana Fez.
Hi, Casey.
Rana Fez, what's up?
Okay.
Hey, listen, I just want to take this opportunity to put a little plea out there to everybody in the tri-state area to not go out and start attacking people of ethnic backgrounds. And not to make a joke of it, but cab drivers and the guys that run the delis, don't go out and start beating these people up because...
Casey, have you heard even one case of that?
You know it's going to happen.
No, no one knows it's going to happen. No one believes that's going to happen.
You know it's going to happen, though, in the next 2 weeks? A month from now?
That cab drivers are going to get beat up, and guys working behind deli counters.
You don't think there's white boys out there that are going to start getting pissed off and doing that stuff?
Well, I would see no reason why, Casey. I would see no reason why, you know, just why white people shouldn't have been beat up when the bombing took place in Oklahoma, which was done by a white guy.
Sure.
But he didn't represent white people, nor did he represent Americans. So, obviously...
Yes, and like that ever has to be said. Please do not hit the man making your sandwich.
Hey, John, you're on Rana Fez. How you doing, buddy?
Hi, John.
Hi, how you doing?
Hanging in there.
Hello?
Yeah,
go ahead, John.
Hi, how you doing, Rana Fez? I live in, like, central Jersey. It's by Ford's, like, off of Perth Amboy.
Yeah.
So all you walk out, you see, it's only a black cloud of smoke. That's all you see.
Mm-hmm.
Scary.
Thank you, John.
Yeah. Thank you, buddy. That's
Perth
John.
Amboy.
He's scared.
I'm scared in Perth Amboy.
Yeah. 877-692-1027. We're going to be here tonight to take your phone calls and listen to you.
Vincent, you're on Rana Fez.
What's up, guys? Yeah. Caller before the last guy kind of stole my thunder.
Yeah.
You think, like, I live in Astoria. There's a big Arab community. You think anyone's going to, like, start attacking them?
No.
But, like, why not, though? I mean, think about, like, someone loses their kid, you know? Like, they'll slip out, you know? Like, there's some crazy Europeans here.
Someone who lost a loved one today is really going to have other things to deal with than going to Astoria Arab hunting.
But, I mean, that's today, though, you know? Like, you're right. Like, you must just feel, like, enormous amounts of pain right now. But eventually that pain's going to turn to anger.
All right, thanks, Vincent. Well,
am I being naive, Ronnie, and thinking that people aren't going to start just attacking cab drivers and deli owners randomly?
Especially when it seems to be a single terrorist group or maybe even a group of groups that are minority even in their own country.
Sure.
So it'll be interesting to see what the president does over the next couple of days. I'm fairly sure, Fez, that he's not going to say, let's get deli owners and cab drivers.
Right, let's hope so.
All right, here's Christopher. Christopher, you're on Rana Fez.
Hi, Christopher.
Hey, how you doing, guys, man?
Yeah.
You actually read one of my emails not too long ago.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, it was the Puerto Rican guy, the girls with big asses and everything.
Okay.
Yeah, they called me into work. I'm a security guard.
Yeah.
And on my way over here, they were, like, looking at me weird and stuff. I was getting hard looks.
Yeah.
You know, because I'm a Puerto Rican, but I look a little Arabic. I'm thinking, great, I hope no one's going to, you know, do something stupid to me today.
So you had to start speaking Spanish to everybody.
Oh, yeah. I was like, great, you know.
Yeah.
And I was worried about that because I haven't shaved today. I'm totally unprepared. I'm at work out of uniform and everything here.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, thanks, Christopher.
No problem.
All right, bye. No, honestly, folks, do not think that you're helping in any way.
Yeah.
By pointing any of your anger... And any other Americans.
Yeah, you're not helping one American cause by doing that with any sort of slurs and or attacks.
Hey, Matt. Matt, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
How's it going, Ron and Fez?
We're hanging in here tonight and leaving our phone lines open.
Go ahead, Matt.
There is reportings here in the sequel, because they closed off Route 3, that there's a van and there's a chemical warfare. There's reports here in this area in Bergen County.
Matt, I think we would have heard that by here. So
that's what I hear around here.
Where are you hearing it from, Matt?
It's from a local police department in town.
All right, Matt, under no circumstances spread any kind of rumors that you don't know to be true, right?
I pretty much do know it is true. I'm not definitely sure, but they have the FBI there and local police departments and state police there.
All right, hold on, Matt. We're going to talk to you out there.
Okay.
Which,
there's a lot of things that a lot of authorities have to check out
right
today.
Hey, Rob, you are on our office.
Hi, Rob.
Hey, what's up, guys?
Hey, buddy.
And what a sad day, huh?
It's the saddest day I can imagine.
I never would believe that the Twin Towers would be gone.
They're gone, and all those people are gone, and we're not even going to start and realize how terrible this is until a lot of time passes.
Yeah, you're right. Hey, I want to know, when these planes, when they went off course, what happened? Like, how come they were diverted to New York so easily and nobody was, like, aware? You know what I mean?
I don't know what they do as a plane goes off course. I don't know whether, you know, people think that they should, shoot them down immediately. You know, if someone does get grabbed by a terrorist plane, we don't normally think, all right, we should knock it out of the air, do we?
I don't think that's the first plan.
Imagine, if that was your family on the... what would you do with them then, Rob?
Well, I don't know. Go on alert. I don't really know, to tell you the truth.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, this has really never happened before, where someone stole commercial airliners and flew them into city buildings.
Yeah, you're right. All right.
Thanks, Rob.
Hey, I want to say see ya. See ya.
There you go. So I don't even know if there is a plan for that.
And I'm sure it's not just blowing them out of the air, although we really don't know what happened to that one in Pennsylvania yet.
Yeah, the one that crashed just outside of Pittsburgh.
Yeah. Hey, Hector.
Yeah, Ron and Fez.
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead, buddy.
Yeah, you know, my aunt works for the Port Authority, and she must have worked in the World Trade for at least 20 years as a supervisor there. And they decided to transfer her to the 42nd Street bus terminal. Well, her last day was supposed to be today, but she decided to start at the terminal today, and she left yesterday. She made it by one day.
I think probably another thing we're going to be hearing, Fezzy, over the next few weeks is all those kinds of stories.
Sure.
Some of them that are, that's lucky like this, and other ones that are completely unlucky.
Yeah, she was there also for the 93 bombing, and she got bumped and bruised during that one.
Uh-huh.
So God was on her side.
Yeah.
Got her out early. Okay, fellas.
All right.
See ya.
Yeah, the odd thing is, I was in the World Trade Center in April, and I feel like I was lucky to get away.
Yeah, I mean, anybody who's been up in that building, I can't imagine, Fezzy. I just can't imagine.
Right.
What it was like to be in that building when it exploded.
Unbelievable. Now, we spoke earlier about the airlines and that. I think the word is that there will be no commercial air flight until at least noon tomorrow.
Is that right? Anywhere in the country?
Right. I think commercial air flight will start again, possibly at noon tomorrow. Someone, if you would, get on a computer and check that for me.
We got to work something out with Billy and Hawk.
Okay. They couldn't find each other earlier.
Yeah, I know. Where were they?
Never mind the fact of finding any sort of credible information.
And then I went outside. Remember when I went outside when the Hawk was talking?
Uh-huh.
And Billy was in the corner smoking.
Really? you know, we...
I just cracked up.
We got to have the Great American Smokeout around here because people are just abandoning the posts left and right to have a ciggy butt.
Here's the mad producer, Fuzzy, who said he'd never call us back again. Here he is,
that
the
was
mad
just
producer.
Last night, yeah. Hey, mad producer.
What's up, guys? First of all, I didn't say I'd never call back. I called in under my regular name, which is Ron, because I figured on a day like today, we should put all this little nonsense aside. Ronnie, I had pretty much the same morning you did. I was scrambling to pick up my kids. And then this afternoon, something hit me. I fly a lot. And since the mid-70s, security companies and pilots associations were asking the airlines to put in bulletproof and break-in-proof cockpit doors. And this has been, I'd say, about 20 years now. Some associations have been trying to get this done. If this would have been in place, at the very worst, they would have took the plane over and some passengers might have died, but they would have never been able to take the planes over. And I think that, if you think about that, it really makes this even 10 times more sadder that this was an avoidable tragedy.
Have we ever been in a situation where somebody took a plane and used it as kamikaze?
Yes, there was a FedEx flight where it was a FedEx airplane. One of the crewmen went nuts, attacked the pilot and the co-pilot with a hammer.
Oh, yeah, tried to put it into Memphis.
Right. Then there was the Egypt airline, which they're still trying to debate what happened to that and why that went down.
Yeah.
Then in the Middle East, I think in the 70s, that TWA flight, remember they got into the cockpit and they had the gun to the pilot's head and they shot him and they threw him out the window.
Yeah, but I'm saying they were trying to use the plane like they did today as a kamikaze situation.
Yeah, but between all the movies and between common sense and between past experiences, it would just tell you. I mean, listen, do you remember that flight from Phoenix to Vegas where that kid went nuts and kicked in the door?
Is that the one that they sat on until he died?
Yes, and they killed him. You guys fly. I fly a lot. And the door, that cockpit door, is paper thin. You could basically kick it open. I mean, honestly, I'm not trying to sound like a note or whatever, but this is such a sad day that I am. And this just hit me like an hour ago. I literally started getting choked up thinking all of these people died for something that should not have happened. You can't stop bombs. You can't stop weapons. But what you could do is you could stop people from getting control of the plane.
Just think,
common sense. You just put a thicker door with a good lock. They take the plane over. Even make it a bulletproof door. What is it? I mean, this day and age, you have bulletproof cars for sale. BMW makes a bulletproof car. You're going to tell me they can't put a bulletproof door on a cockpit plane?
I'm sure after today, Ron, they'll be looking at all different types of security things.
Think about how many people died today.
Right.
Hold on.
We all got your point. Everybody understands you, Ron.
Yeah.
But here's what I'm saying. I'm not ready to, point fingers at... You know, security people. I mean, it's terrorism.
No,
if it isn't one, here's the thing.
Blame the security people. They make
right. But I'm saying,
you're never going to stop everybody.
Right.
My point is,
no matter what we do, we're never going to stop everybody.
Okay. Yeah.
No matter what happens,
and we have no details of exactly what happened in those aircrafts.
Or you could end up being one of these poor bastards who lives in a bomb shelter in Montana and never really gets around to living a life.
Obviously I'm not saying about it, but I'm saying there's common sense things to do to avoid problems like this. And with our economy and with our way of life and with what has been going on in the world for the past 30 years, honestly, if you think about it and just think about it logically, this is inexcusable.
All right, guys.
I'm just giving my state of peace. And again, I wish you guys the best. And my condolences to everybody.
All right, thanks a lot, Ron.
Bye, guys.
Thanks, Matt, producer.
A lot of people, Fezzi, want to feel as soon as something happens, who's responsible? Is it
right.
Is it the government? Is it the security at the airlines? Where's the CIA been? And then, you know what you forget is in times when everything's rolling along, and it's hard to remember last week, but there was a last week, and we were all happy-go-lucky. And you get on the plane and they keep, and you've either done it yourself, you've seen people start and get a little pissy because they won't leave you alone while you're trying to get on the door.
Right.
Most people won't even listen while they're giving the safety things on a plane. Most people are like, come on, take the hell off. Because it's an everyday occurrence. It's a normal thing.
Sure. And the map producer has his security theories. And of course, now if you listen to my mother and her theory of what happened today, that the pilots were in on it.
No.
Mad producer's ideas still wouldn't have worked.
I don't know what the situation is, but obviously we're not at that point that we're ready to say, here, who's at fault? I mean, literally, Fezzi, it's been a little over 12 hours since they attacked our city, since they attacked New York City.
And as much as people want it, you're not going to get definitive answers.
And they
probably for a long time, if ever.
They destroyed the World Trade Center. The World Trade Center, Fezzi, gone.
Absolutely gone.
All those people, we've got numbers of trying to figure out how many policemen are missing, how many firefighters are missing. The numbers at this point, and we're just talking missing, are staggering. They're frightening.
You want to talk about how you feel? 877-692-1027. We do have this. Yes, all commercial airplanes grounded until at least noon tomorrow. And also, New York City Mayor Rudy Giuliani is asking people to stay home on Wednesday.
And yes, I am well aware that today is 9/11. Everybody wants to bring that up.
All right, yeah.
And that they tried to make it happen at 9/11.
Sure. The first actual attack on one of the Twin Towers happened at about 8:45. The second one was attacked just shortly after 9 a.m., Following that, an American Airlines flight crashed into the Pentagon about 9:40. Finally, a United Airlines flight that had been hijacked was the one that crashed southeast of Pittsburgh around 10 a.m.
Yeah.
It's the series of events as they went down today.
Who would have ever thought, Fezzi, that, and with me, if you ask me, airport security is tight.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you're not even a comfortable flyer, Fez, but do you ever worry about airport security?
No, uh-uh.
To me, they seem like they don't leave me alone for a second.
They look at everything.
And I'm spending my time going, it's a cigar clip. I need it to clip the end of my cigar. I'm not going to try to take over the phone with a cigar, the plane with a cigar clip.
Right, and as that guy that goes through ahead of you, and he gets beeped, and they send him through again, and he gets beeped again, then they take the little electronic paddle over him, and people are just so antsy. Because it's like, oh, just let the guy go.
Right. That is literally what you said.
It must be his fillings. Let him go.
Yeah. I mean, we go through that constantly. Hey, Craig. Craig, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, Craig.
How you doing, buddy?
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Yeah.
Funny. I have a 6 and 3-year-old, and I fly into L.A. once a month. My wife and I are separated. And like Fezzi, I'm not the world's greatest flyer. I don't like turbulence. But I'm just wondering how things are going to be different, because I, like you said, I'm one of the few people that actually pays attention to the safety videos.
Right.
No one ever does. And I fly a lot. I just wonder, and I'm flying this Monday. I just wonder how things are going to be different than my other flights. I have no idea how people are going to react. What do you guys think?
I think that it's really hard to imagine how we are going to feel about the anti-terrorist thing in this for the rest of this year. I think that people are going to be more paranoid and want more answers ever than before. We have a Republican president. We have a Republican Congress right now, Fez, and they are going to start calling for security measures, defense measures, and it'll probably be the most strict and greatest we've ever had in the history of this country. That's what I'm guessing.
Hey, Fez, you know how you said let people get annoyed and just say let them go through? I'm imagining that when I go to the airport next Monday that
everyone's going to be very cooperative with security.
This week, but then, Craig, believe me, life goes on. It always does.
Uh-huh.
It always goes on. And this is not the first terrorist attack in this country, though. You know, I was listening to ONA, and I forget which one of them brought it. I think Opie said, it's amazing how they keep upping it now.
Oh, right, yeah.
Upping it every time it comes back. And that is literally true. I mean, we couldn't have imagined a worse bombing than what happened at Oklahoma City.
And then we get this situation.
You know, I looked over...
Three different buildings attacked.
I started to think about it, and I saw the pictures again in my head.
Yeah. And I was supposed to fly this weekend. That flight is off.
Yeah, there's no. You're not going anywhere this weekend. Besides, no. Notre Dame's going to lose. 877-692.
It was off last Saturday when they played Nebraska.
Matter of fact, if I was you, I'd call for the NCAA to disband for 4 years.
To investigate and disband the program and give Notre Dame.
4 years to give that school and all the a chance to catch up.
Right. Give it 4 years to weed out all the poison.
Checking in on some of the people that we've had as callers over the past year and a half or so, Fezzy, and a lot of times it's good to hear from these people. Here's one we haven't talked to in a while. It's Baby Anna. Baby Anna, how you doing, honey?
Hi,
Baby
guys.
Anna.
Hey.
I'm a little shaken up. You know, this morning I drive into school. I go to school in Long Island, but we were a little early, so we figured we were in Queens, and we said, well, let's just take a drive around the city. And that was about 8:20. And we drove through the city. We kept on going to the lower numbers. I wanted to go visit my old job, which is at East 13th and 2nd Avenue.
Uh-huh.
So we were around that area, and for some reason, we didn't go straight there. We were just driving around, and the whole ground was just people were running everywhere. And we said, what's going on? And everyone was just screaming and yelling. So not the smartest thing, but we wanted to see what was going on. And you couldn't really get that far because it was just so many people in the streets and everything. And we got to a spot where we could just see the second plane come into the other building.
Oh, and you saw it actually happen.
You saw it happen, huh?
Yeah, I was, there were no words. It was just like a movie. I couldn't even believe it was real. And there was just people, and you could see people from where we were. We couldn't see the bottom. But we could see people jumping from the top, and, you know, obviously they were from really high, and they probably didn't make it, but, oh, it was horrible. And, you know, I have a bad heart, and I was getting so much anxiety problems, but the people of the city were really, really nice. Everyone was just trying to help everyone. People were letting us into their stores and giving people water and food.
Yeah, I saw a lot of that today, too, and I saw a lot of the same thing.
People letting other people inside their cars.
Yeah, yeah. People were just, stopping tourists that were panicking a little bit and saying, here's where you need to be going. Because can you imagine, Fezzy, you know, you come into this town, if you don't know it, you're already intimidated.
Sure, yeah.
And something like this takes place.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was just total confusion. And
did you have trouble getting out, Baby Anna?
Oh, we had to walk.
Oh, okay.
He left his car there, and it was just, there were so many people everywhere anyway that even if we had tried to driven, we wouldn't have gotten anywhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And,
you walked the Manhattan Bridge or what?
Yeah, the Manhattan Bridge. And you know what that guy called in before and said that people were going to start attacking people of different nationalities?
Yeah.
I really actually believe that, you know, not everyone, but there are going to be some people that look at people the wrong way. Like, we saw this family in a car, and they obviously weren't American. I'm not sure what they were. They were very dark-skinned and had that look. And the kid that I was in a car with, he was very upset because his girlfriend was around that area, and he was just out of his mind at the time. He took his bat out of the back seat of his car and went to go over to that other car. I stopped him, but I'm just saying that it is possible that could happen.
Well, I mean, Anna, you know, maybe that's where we have to be. It's just stop people that are acting crazy because it's not the people who did this. Just because
Absolutely.
They look different, just because they talk different, they are not the people who did this.
I agree with that 100%. I think that now people will kind of, like that guy who called before, he said, you know, he's not black or whatever, everyone's American. I've never been patriotic myself, but today, even watching the news and watching in that other country, them dance around and laughing, you want to do everything that you can and just help. And even if you have to go to war, there's so many people who now are behind it and would definitely fight for this.
Anna, thanks for calling us, honey. I'm glad you're okay.
Okay, bye.
All right, thanks, bye-bye. Baby Anna. Be careful out there.
None of one of the regulars there, Fezzy, 877-692-1027. Found yourself at the wrong place, wrong time, like so many people did today. So many people.
Just decided to cruise into the city. found herself in that situation. On the traffic front, the Holland and Lincoln tunnels are still closed, Ronnie.
Yeah, you don't want to be coming into the city also tomorrow, folks, unless, for whatever reason, you have to be here.
Right.
Come in. If not, there's no sense. Please, the mayor says, please stay out of New York tomorrow.
Let Jeremy Coleman know that I have a note from the mayor.
Yeah.
877-692-1027.
Hey, Jason. Jason, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hi, Jason.
Hey, Ron and Fez, what's up?
Hey.
Not that much. I just wanted to express my concerns and thoughts about today's event. I don't really, you know, what's going on. I went to work today, and I didn't see none of the footage. I've been hearing, you know, you, the sports guys, Dynamite, Kobe, Anthony.
Right, everybody talking about it.
Yeah,
right.
And I haven't seen any of the footage, and I actually just got home, and I just sat down, and I just hugged my kids and hugged my wife, because it's a very important time, you know, for us fathers and mothers to, you know, get together just to be with one another. I think as parents, we have to be there for one another. I think as Americans, we need to just stand and unite. We don't need to be looking at this person down the block, looking at this person down the street, you know, causing emotion. I just want to stress the fact that I think tonight and for the next couple of days and weeks, we all need to just say a prayer for those who are gone, for those who are missing and still need to be recovered. And we just need to be for each other.
Thank you, Jason.
All right, have a good night.
Thank you, buddy. Well said.
You know, making Jason's point back about if you really want to let these terrorists win this thing, start, you know, staring at your neighbor. Start staring at people who speak differently than you and start accusing them. And that's what they want us to do. They want us to live in fear. They want, you know, and, obviously it's not at the a point where we talk about rebuilding yet, Fezzi, or whether what we do with that area. But to me, I say you rebuild it and you say to these people, you don't get to tell us how we're going to live. You don't get to dictate to us how Americans and New Yorkers in particular are going to live their life.
Sure. It's not a point where we're going to decide, all right, now we're just going to have very low buildings that are bomb-proof.
Right.
You know, we're not going to go live in bunkers. We're not going to stay underground. You can't make us.
It's a rough night, perhaps the saddest night in the history of New York. Here's Earl who made it in tonight. What time did you get in, Earl?
I got here about 6.
How were you able to get back through?
No, service was perfectly restored by the time. I just, like a lot of people, watch TV and just my mouth hanging open.
All day long?
Pretty much.
Yeah.
And I got on my bed, I closed my eyes, and I'm like, okay, I'm going to wake up. This is a bad dream. It'll be a really bad dream. And I woke up, put the TV back on. It was still going. I was like, this isn't a dream. I still can't believe it.
It is shocking, and it does feel like, it felt like a huge part of me today. I felt like I was just in a dream state. When I was running to those schools looking for my kids, did not even feel like myself. I think that's where the, wow, this feels like a movie. Most of the day I was feeling that way.
And everything, seeing people, everything seemed to be moving in slow motion.
Yeah, I walked over to the train station. It's about a 15-minute walk, and I made it a point to look at everyone, and everyone just has this glassy,
so many people,
blank stares, and
with their hands just over their mouth.
Not even hands. I mean, just like they were doing their everyday business, but they weren't there. Mm-hmm. It was just very surreal. Then I got on the train, and everyone's just sitting there in just like this like weird coma-like state, just like staring into space.
And everyone that you pass, you know, it was obviously the one thing on their mind.
And the odd thing is, you look like that too. You know what I mean? You look like.
And I caught myself doing it. I was just kind of like.
They're sitting there thinking, look at that guy. He is zoned.
I was just like in this weird zone.
Yeah.
I got off the phone with my brother about 10 minutes ago.
Now he's in the service, right? Or was?
He hasn't been in the service for 10 years. They found him.
Wow.
Called him.
What, AWOL?
No, they called his job and he said, oh, no, are you who you are? And he goes, yes. And he goes, you're on call. He goes, did you serve in the Gulf War? He goes, yes, I did. He goes, you're on call. said, are you prepared to serve? And he went, I haven't served in 10 years. He goes, we don't care.
And they're like,
you're on call.
You don't understand. I have a gut now, and my hamstrings are really tight.
I got bad feet.
Yeah, they asked him if he was fit. He said, are you still fit to serve? And he went, are you kidding me? And they said, no, we're not. We're finding every able body that has any military experience. It's like, you're on call in the event we declare war.
Send in a pair of his jeans with his waist size on it.
Please.
I don't know how fit he is to serve.
Use that as a tent for some of the kids over there. We said we would just hang out tonight. If you're really looking for the hard news, Tent End wins.
Right.
Best place to get it. Of course, go to TV.
If you want to talk about the situation and just how it makes you feel, no matter which way that is, give us a call here, 877-692-1027.
Here is John. John, you're on the Ron and Fez show. How you doing, buddy?
Hey, guys.
Yeah. Hey, John.
How are you?
Yeah.
Go ahead, buddy.
Just wanted to say that it was great to go down to try to give blood and just see the whole support of all the New Yorkers out there.
Where were you, John?
Went to two places. First, I went to NYU.
Uh-huh.
They weren't taking any new people. They were fully booked. And then went up to the blood center on 67th between 1st and 2nd. And giving priority to guys with O positive and O negative.
So actually lines at both of those places.
Yeah, and there were just tons of people just all wanted to give blood.
That's cool to hear.
It was great for, you know, these New Yorkers to just be out there and so supportive.
Well, yeah, the city to me has, and the country, of course, reacted great. By the way, here's some blood donation lines. 1-800-HELP-NOW or 1-800-933-BLOOD. Also, here's another number. They're looking for people with medical experience. Volunteers are needed. Please give them a call at 1-800-628-0193. 1-800-628-0193. Heroics took place in front of our eyes today, Fezzy. A lot of heroes out there and a lot of heroes who lost their lives, our friends, our neighbors, policemen, firemen, EMT, just people on the street trying their best to help out. An amazing day in New York during our saddest day in the history of New York.
Now, thanks for the call, John.
Here's Rob. Rob, you're on Ron and Fez. How you doing, Rob?
Hi, Rob.
Hey, how you doing, guys?
Hi, my friend.
All right. Hey, I'm a New York City police officer, and I mean, this is by far the saddest day. I mean, I'm a young guy, but by far the saddest day of my entire life. On the radio, not the regular radio, the police radios, we actually heard a female police officer come to her death as she was caught in the rubble on the third floor in the second building when it collapsed. It was just so scary.
She was she had made her way there to as part of the rescue effort.
Yeah, we had hundreds of officers and et cetera. Inside the building, when the building collapsed, 10 seconds later, you heard over the phone, and it was basically a shriek. Yeah, you heard her voice. She just came over and what's called the 1013. You also needs assistance, and we were just trying to get her location, and she had her finger on the button for the radio, and she's just calling out. And everybody's trying to ask her, what's her location? And, you heard what seemed to be basically her last breath come out of her mouth. As she just, uttered, and that was it. And, I mean, we lost hundreds of cops today, and even more so on the firemen and everything else. The entire city, all the police officers and everyone else, we're all on standby. I'm sure everyone condolences to everyone's families. I know my family was worried about my own behalf. Just horrible.
Yeah, just horrible, Rob.
Just one of those days.
Incredibly awful story, Rob.
And Fez, there's thousands of them.
Too fake. Yeah. You heard it, and it was the movies. I mean, you guys, I'm sure, all listen to 1010 Wins and all these other radio stations. Myself and, obviously all the other
people that, you know, that had it to, you know, available to them, all listening to it live and happening, and
right.
You know, getting up to the second, you know, updates from people that are there at the time, you know, hearing these things go down, and I mean, but you know, I mean, the cops and you know, and all the personnel, I mean, like everyone's been saying, and you know, giving their, you know, their hero stories, you know, everybody just coming in on their own time, guys,
sure. Mm-hmm.
Guys coming in from being, you know, sick, you know, people that are. You know, but whatever, broken arms, et cetera, just coming in, you know, just there saying, hey, you know, I'm a body, you know, whatever, send me wherever you want to send me. It was obviously not something to smile about today, but, you know, when you put it in perspective, it was just something to be joyous about that, everybody's there, it's for everyone.
There definitely, pride in the number of, heroic stories today. Thank you so much, Rob.
All right, thank you.
And best luck to you and all the families of the police officers out there, Fezzy, the EMTs, the firemen.
Just heroes that go in to do their job without even considering what can happen to them. Just showing up there on the scene.
Doctors and nurses coming from all over.
There's that
volunteer
one,
workers.
There's that one video that's been on TV of the doctor that was in the area. He actually had a video camera with him, videotaped the collapse. You see everything coming down on him. He says a couple of times, I hope I live, I hope I live. He makes it through that onslaught and then goes charging right forward towards everything. His next words are, I've got to see if I can help some people here. So basically, you know, just filming his own efforts to get into the situation. And just, in such a horrible, horrible mess.
An amazing day today, Fezzy. So many stories. And it's going to take us forever to figure out exactly all the stories that took place today.
Mm-hmm. When it's time to just, when finally the fires are out and we can start digging into that rubble, it's going to take forever to find out exact numbers. But we're going to carry on, because that's what we do.
Here's Eric. Eric, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, Eric.
Terrible, terrible, stunning day today, huh?
Yeah.
But there's one good thing, that Fez wasn't in those hallways counting steps, holding people up in that trade center, huh?
That's true. I count steps.
Eric looking for some jokes tonight. All right. There it is, buddy. You know, Fez, he gave it a shot.
Oh yeah,
no,
and everyone's
going to
handle it a different way.
Yeah, on a normal night we'd be running with that. Howard, you're
Hey, good evening, Ron and Fez.
Hi, Ron and Fez.
Hey, evening, Ron and Fez.
Hey, how are you, Howard?
Good. I just have a personal point, and then maybe something that I can offer out to the listeners as a way of striking back and healing. My personal point is, I don't think today was a coincidence as far as the particular date, like 9/11.
Yeah, I'm hearing that from a lot of people.
Right, but the point that I'm really called about was that, you know, you get a lot of calls and you listen to a lot of shows and everybody feels like, you know, they're hopeless and not helpless and they really can't strike back and they want to do something. But I really think that every one of your listeners and anybody that can be reached out to should leave a light on tonight. Because, you know, in the old days, you know, when they used to have bombings, they used to turn the lights out at night. And I think that every American should send a message by leaving a light on their home that, you know, here we are and we're America and we're not afraid.
Thank you for calling, Howard. It's amazing, Fezzy. It's not the type of world you ever wanted to raise your kids in.
No, not whatsoever. And Howard said, the frustration and the helplessness of feeling like there's no way you could have stopped this. How do you stop an airliner from coming into a building?
Well, that will be the challenge that the president was talking about.
877-692-1027.
You know, we're getting a lot of updates on different hospitals and how many people they have in. And I think the best thing to do is, if you want that kind of news, is to go to 1010 Wins rather than have us do it. What we were going to do tonight is just to leave the phone lines open, Fezzy, and take your calls, because it's a shared experience. And a lot of the people that listen to the radio station here in New York, WNEW, after a certain amount of time, a lot of us feel like we all know each other.
Right.
And we all went through this together.
And in a situation today where everyone, there's probably not anyone left that hasn't seen some of the footage that went down today, and you sit in your living rooms, and you see what's going on, and you know what's going on, and you're frustrated, and you want to yell at the TV, or you want to express something. Well, here's where you can do that. 877-692-1027. That's on our show, and we're going to be here
Billy,
for the next few hours letting you do it.
All right, well, then why write it down? Jimmy. Jimmy, you're on Ronifest.
Hi, Jimmy.
How you doing, buddy?
How you doing?
Yeah.
Yeah, guys, a crazy sight down here. We're all sitting here, there's a few hundred cops on standby waiting to go into Manhattan.
Where are you right now, Jimmy?
We're near the Navy Yard on standby.
Uh-huh. And what are they going to just bring in the shifts, or how's that going to work out?
Well, they haven't worked out the details yet, so they're pretty much telling us close to nothing.
Yeah.
So we're waiting here to get orders to go into to Manhattan and help with the rescue and going through the debris and the rubble, looking for survivors, and help the fire department with their efforts.
Now, Jimmy, you know, when we're talking about a lot of the people missing at this time, we're talking about the police themselves.
Well, what the media is telling us right now, well, what the media is telling everybody, their numbers are not the same numbers that we got. The numbers that we got are close to 1,500 missing firefighters and police unaccounted for.
Oh, my gosh.
And that's nowhere near what the media is saying.
Right, there is nowhere near. Just to give us an idea, Jimmy, how many police and firefighters are we talking about that even are in New York at any given time?
Oh, that are in Manhattan at this point? There's.
I mean, at any given time, how many
right,
are actually
on a regular day?
How many just serve?
Well, there's 40,000 police officers, to know how many are working in Manhattan, combined with the fire department, there's thousands.
Right.
You know that'll be first responders to something like this.
And at this time, from what you've heard, at least 1,500 missing police
and firefighters combined. And what they're doing right now is they're going from station house to station house, both fire station houses and police station houses, and doing a full head count to get an exact number.
Mm-hmm.
But the number that I got right now is definitely more accurate than what the media was originally given to everybody.
And what's the next step for you guys? When do you go into South Manhattan?
Well, we don't know that yet. That's why we're sitting by, standing by. A lot of the cops are on their cell phones right now trying to get in touch with other police officers that they haven't heard from. So there's a lot of emotion down here. A lot of cops that are missing, the cops that I'm with right now, they know, and they're panicking, and it's very emotional, not hearing from certain police officers that you know for a long time. Every police officer that I know, that I'm close with, that I'm friends with personally, I've personally accounted for. So I'm not one of them. But there are people around here that are looking for their friends and their brothers and relatives that are on the job, and they're not finding them, and then they're getting very worried and very emotional, very upset. So it's hard on everybody. Cousin is a fighter, and he's in Manhattan right now. My wife just spoke to his family, and they got word that he lost half his company.
Mm.
So half a company is a lot of firefighters.
Yeah, and you also brought that up, that a lot of these firefighters, Fez, they all come out of the same family. You have cousins,
right,
brothers,
exactly.
Uncles,
it's
generations.
Yeah, it's a job of family members. It's a lot of family. A lot of brothers on the job, and it's hard on everybody.
Jimmy, best of luck to you, okay, buddy?
Okay, thank you very much. Oh, by the way, my wife also works in the World Trade Center, and this is what actually got me on the air because of what happened to me this morning. She was on her way to go to work, and she was hesitant because she wasn't feeling well, and she was out the door. And she was running late, and next thing you know it, I'm looking at the TV, and there it is. And she came running back in, and all her friends, every one of her friends, and all of her girlfriends that she grew up with,
were in World Trade 2, which was the second building to get hit. They were all there when the second plane hit. And luckily enough, all of them made it out. But I managed to stay home and make sure.
I think we lost Jimmy the Comp.
It's his cell phone went off as he. Jimmy is a police officer, and he says the kind of numbers that they're talking about is at least 1,500 police and firefighters missing at this time. That's not any official number. That's just he sent some of the number that the police have been talking about with each other.
As they're trying to do some sort of head count.
That's a staggering figure so big I can't even comprehend.
You can't imagine. You know, it's picturing 1,500 people that are, you know, according to Jimmy the Cop, of course, like Ronnie said, no numbers official that they're looking for right now.
Fezzy, I bet we don't have an official number weeks from now.
Oh, right, yeah. Definitely.
I got this on the instant feedback that the usual line of tractors, bulldozers, dump trucks, etc. Just one heading down on 2nd Avenue. People cheering them as they're going by. You have to wonder, how long is that area going to be dangerous?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so much rubble down there. And, you know, buildings that, you know, that are just surrounding the World Trade Center area that have been damaged. And, of course, World Trade Center number 7 also collapsed today.
Which was, what was it, like a 48-story building, Fez? Normally,
right, I think that's what we heard, yeah.
Normally, under any other circumstances, be considered a huge building, a skyscraper. Today, that will just be a footnote to the kind of devastation that took place downtown in Manhattan. 877-692-1027. I'm going to put Mikey on the phone. Mikey, you're on with Ron and Fez. How you doing, buddy?
Hey, Mikey.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hey, how you doing? First-time caller.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yes, we got you, pal.
You're on, Mikey.
Listen, guys, I've been listening to you guys for a long time now, and, hello?
Yes,
yeah,
we're
go
here.
Ahead.
It's your phone that keeps going
out.
Yeah, it's on your side, bud.
Okay, I've been a long time listener, and there's a first time caller, and I, you guys know that, my uncle, he was, in the building at the time. We just found out over an hour and a half ago that, he lost his hand. Hello?
Yes, I'm listening to you, Mike.
He lost his hand, and he's in one of the hospitals. I'm still trying to get through to my family, but my mother tells me that there's no word exactly what hospital he's in right now.
Okay, so he's alive and they got him out, but he's lost a hand.
Thank God. Thank God.
Right.
You know, this is devastating. You know, this kind of terrorism that's going on, you know, it has, you know, the president has to denounce this. They have to denounce this because we can't continue to go on with this kind of situation in our country, you know. I spent 4 years in the military. I was with the Marines. And in that time, when Saddam Hussein was, you know, acting up, so to speak, we had gone into his country and we fought the war and we won against them. And now we have to deal with this, whether it's, well, it's speculation at this point.
Yeah.
But Bin Salim, whatever his name is.
Bin
Osama Bin Laden.
Yeah, you know, they're saying more or less that he's involved with this. And I feel that, you know, I'm a Democrat, but I'm behind President Bush 100% if he, you know, decides to go to war with this country. And, you know, just to make a point, Americans will not tolerate this at all, period. And, to lose someone in my family or to get someone hurt in my family after I've served for my country, I will not tolerate that.
Yeah, I mean, because we're using the word terrorism, Fezzy, the fact that it's probably the worst attack on the United States since Pearl Harbor, probably, more lives lost here than at Pearl Harbor.
Uh-huh.
It's staggering.
It's a tragedy.
Yeah.
You know, it's a tragedy, basically.
Hi, Mikey. Thanks, my friend. God bless you. Okay, buddy?
You guys take it easy, man.
All right, will do.
Thanks for the call, Mikey. Yeah, and the run of emotions of just being heartbroken, to being angry, to being disgusted, to being just sad beyond belief.
And one of the tougher ones to deal with that hits you every once in a while is just a numbness where, you know, some people are watching this on TV and just it's difficult to take in.
Yeah.
It's difficult to take it in.
It's so much to process, the amount of life that's lost and the number that that's going to end up being. Then the fact that nobody was safe in New York today.
Yeah.
And you take that in and how the attack was done.
Right.
To try to take that in. That actual commercial airliners from our country were hijacked, stolen, our property taken, and used in this attack against us. And, you know, all right, here's a report that came in saying that all that's left of the Twin Towers is only two stories high. That those 110-story towers, those magnificent Twin Towers, are down to two stories of rubble. It's too much to take in, on, you know, 12 hours into it.
Yeah, we're just coming up on about 13 hours ago that this happened.
And when it just kept happening,
yeah.
You saw the one tower get hit. And as you're standing there in disbelief at a gaping, burning hole in one of the Twin Towers, you see the other tower hit. Then you find out, minutes later, the Pentagon's been struck. And you wonder, when's it going to stop?
Amazing. Hey, Anna. Anna, you're on the Ron and Fez show. How you doing, Anna?
Hi,
hey. Anna.
How you guys doing?
Good.
We can barely hear you, hon.
Okay. You know, all I want to say is it's so upsetting. Every time I watch on TV and I see the Twin Towers collapsing one after the other, every time I say, please don't. Please. You know, I'm...
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Every time I'm begging that it doesn't happen. And it does. It's very upsetting. I don't know.
I understand what you're saying, honey.
Yes. Well, thank you. And thanks for being on.
Okay, Anna. Bye-bye.
Bye.
877-692-1027 is the toll-free phone number if you just want to let us know how you feel.
Josh, you're on Ron and Fez.
Oh, hey, guys.
Yeah.
It's my first time calling. I just wanted to say that, you know, you said earlier how when you were in New York, you heard the, you know, plane going over your head, and you were scared and all that. And the Israelis, for the past 30, 40 years, have been going through that, you know? The fear every day.
Yeah. Yes, Israel has lived with a lot of terrorism over the years. It's something that we've been gradually picking up in the United States. Of course, nothing, Fezzy, ever of this magnitude.
Right. This report in now, the L.A. Kings, the hockey team, is saying that two of their players, no names, were on American Airlines Flight 11. That was the first plane to strike the first of the Twin Towers.
So that was the Boston to L.A. flight?
That one, yeah. Yeah, Boston to L.A.
All right, thanks, Josh.
That's American Airlines Flight 11.
Bye.
Here's some of the reports we're getting. The World Trade Center towers in downtown Manhattan. Most likely the intense fire were fed by thousands of gallons of jet fuel aboard the two jetliners that were crashed into the buildings.
Yeah, you have to imagine if they left from Boston, those wings were still completely full of fuel.
Yeah. Now, I just took that flight last week on American Airlines, and the pilot said, after we, and I honestly think he said this, but I'm not sure, after we burn off a few thousand gallons or a couple of tons of fuel, then we'll go up higher. And I was thinking to myself, I don't need to be hearing about tons of fuel when I'm up in a plane. You know, keep that to yourself, please.
Right. One time when I was on the flight from Tampa back to New York, there was bad weather in a certain area. So we actually had to circle Columbia, South Carolina, while we waited for the weather to pass. And actually, what happened was it was just a backlog of planes trying to get into the New York area. That's why we had to circle. And so, you know me, I get nervous, and I ask. And the guy said, oh, trust me, we have enough fuel on board to last, you know, 4, 5, 6 hours longer than we would actually need it for the flight. at that point, it sounded like a good thing. And you realize just how much gasoline and fuel these jetliners are carrying.
So, I mean, so they went out of their way to pick out ones that they knew would have extra gasoline and fuel. Fez, you look over this situation, how they put this together. You got to feel to yourself that they had a country behind them in terms of money and organization, or at least something along the lines of a huge organization. It doesn't seem like it's seven guys smoking a hookah pipe over in Afghanistan could have came up with this deal together.
And stealing commercial airliners that close together.
Yeah.
Within minutes of each other taking off.
But before we're going to try to guess on who's behind this and why, you know, we'll leave that up to President Bush and the... and the government, what we did want to talk about tonight, and that's why we're leaving our phone lines open, 877-692-1027, is just what it's like to be in New Yorker today. It's one of the, probably the only ways that we could help out is just to leave these lines open and for you folks that want to call and talk about your feelings that we'll be here for you.
Yeah, you know, we know you're mad. We know that a lot of you are really upset and sad. And also feeling helpless, frustrated, angry, whatever you got going, 877-692-1027. We're here for you.
Hey, Ron, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, guys. How you guys doing? I know that's not the question I should be asking. But, yeah, my day started out with coffee, and I just turned on the radio. And it was like total chaos at 9 a.m.
Mm-hmm.
It's like the world just got turned upside down, and I sat myself down, and I just started crying, and I realized that, like, this was only the beginning. And then, of course, another plane hit the second tower, and then a plane hit the Pentagon. And I just kept wondering how many more things were going to keep hitting somewhere.
Yeah, that's where it got really, really super scary, the fact that we don't know where this is going to end.
And I also got kind of angry because, you know, these guys tried this before. And obviously, we didn't do anything. We said, try it again.
Well, Ron, we're going to see. We'll let the experts decide what exactly happened, what was behind this.
Well, I remember seeing the whole...
people did go to trial.
I remember seeing all the footage on the trial and the last thing that went down and all the, you know, the interesting ways they made it happen. But, you know, I really don't care right now. What I do care about is there's countries that allow these people to live. And our country has the force and the ability to go and just whack these guys. They should all get whacked. All of them.
Thank you for calling, Ron.
I love you guys. Thank you.
See you, buddy.
Thanks for the call.
Man, people feel all different ways. Here is Mike. Mike, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Mike.
Hey, what's up, guys?
Hey, buddy.
I'm not trying to stir up any trouble, but I am going to begin by saying, you know, how many people did we lose during Kuwait or when we bombed Baghdad? Pretty much none. You know, we blew our own helicopter out of the sky or something like that. That was our only tragedy.
All right, where are you going with this?
Where am I going? All right, the point being is that it's, you know, it's a shame that we think we want to go to war over this. We want to kill these people, but it's not the reality. The reality is we watched all this stuff on TV, watched these people getting blown up, and we were like, oh, yeah, they can't do anything to us. And it's unfortunate that, you know, it may be 6 years later, maybe 8 years later, but we're not untouchable. And Americans need to be bigger than this. They need to swallow it and say, we've done some bad. But, you know, this is the only way to let it go is let it go. We go in there and kill some more people, and there's going to be a nuke in New York next time. You know, it's like we've done our damage. You know, and there's no reason to go to war over this. It's time to kind of let it go and be bigger than these people. It's kind of late. You know, we're going to find out that one of these guys was Kuwaiti, the other guy was Iraqi. I mean, these people don't do this for no reason. A guy doesn't fly a 747 into a plane. A half-intelligent man doesn't do that. Unless you kill his family or something. And we've done those things to these people. And it's just, you know, I don't want to talk about going to war over these. It's just, you know, if we find the people responsible, that's good. You know, God bless it. But there's no direct people to be angry at.
Mike, thanks for calling us, buddy. 877-692-1027. Keith, you're on the Ron and Fez show. Hi, Keith.
Ron and Fez, how you doing?
Good.
Go ahead, buddy.
Listen, I'm kind of tongue-tied here, but I just wanted to give you my story. I was on the LIE this morning, and I actually saw the thing burning, and it was horrific, but when I got I went back to be with my family or whatever, and I got to my brother's house, and his little nephew was 2 years old. You know, this little guy, he's just starting to walk and talk, and he grabbed my hand, he grabbed my fingers, and he started pulling me over to the living room, and he started going, hey, Uncle Keith, smoke, and he's pointing at the TV screen, at this carnage, and he's going, smoke, look, smoke.
Mm-hmm.
And like, it's just something I'm never going to forget, because what kind of world are these kids going to grow up in, you know?
It's amazing to think of kids that are going to be born and raised in New York City and, you know, the area, and not know the World Trade Center.
And just not know, like, the feeling of being safe in America. Like,
right.
How close are all of us that are hearing this show right now to this disaster?
Yeah, you're right.
I don't feel safe. Does anybody else?
Yeah. You are correct about that, Keith. It's a day that we lost a lot of our neighbors. I lost a lot of our friends. Some of us lost family. Very, very, very tough day. And a day that people will remember for a long, long time.
And it's going to be a while before we actually find out the exact number of what the loss was.
Where'd these come in from? Did you just find these?
Yeah, I found them in the back, hidden somewhere.
In the back.
We haven't had a Planet Java stash in here in a long time.
Yeah. Hawk found some Planet Java, some Trumbles.
Figured we need them tonight.
Found them stashed in the back. You're holding out on us, Hawk, is what you're doing. I'd love to see this back.
I know.
Where is this back of the station that I'd love to see where all the treasure is stored?
877-692-1027 is the Ron and Fez show. We did not want to come on here and do our normal show, of course. That was impossible to do. We also didn't want to come on here and do a straight news show because we're not newsmen. We're actually comics.
Yeah. Well,
more than we're even broadcasters.
And we get most stuff wrong.
Most people, nobody would actually ever accuse us of being broadcasters. But we feel like we made a relationship with you guys over the past year or so. And just wanted to come in and open up the phone lines, talk to you a little bit.
Sit around and talk to you where it's where we know it's a lot of people looking for some place to talk tonight.
Here's Chris. Chris, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, Chris.
Hey, Ron and Fez, big ass number 8697. I work in Jersey, and this morning got word from a coworker who works in the basement of World Trade Center building number 1 that there was an explosion before anybody knew anything. And I'm 2 minutes from Washington Rock State Park. So we raced to the top of the hill, and there it was. We could see the smoke coming from the tower. By the time we got back to where I work, the second plane had crashed. This was about 9:10, maybe 9:15 this morning. And I have a good friend that works in one of the buildings on the 105th floor. And his cell phone's been dead, and just getting voicemail, no response. And well, everybody here in Jersey, I mean, F-16's been flying over, and that's all you hear.
Yeah, that's pretty eerie.
And now I just flew in. I was Chrissy Chris. I went to the Cayman Islands a couple weeks ago. I called you guys up. I went on vacation, and I had some beautiful pictures of Manhattan, you know, from the airline as we were coming into Newark Airport, and I can't believe what happened, you know?
Yeah.
Just, I can't believe they're gone. You know, but I know we're going to get revenge.
Chris, thanks for calling us, buddy.
All right. Man.
All right. Here's Bob. He's a paramedic who said he was on the scene today. Bob, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hi, Bob.
Hey, how are you?
Hey.
Go ahead, Bob. What happened today for you?
We had set up a triage station at one of the colleges there, and we get firemen here and there coming in, and a group of other firemen would be inside not wondering where everybody was. And it was just kind of like almost a high at times because some guys who haven't seen each other for an hour or so would actually see them together. And it was just an ecstatic, positive feeling for these guys knowing
just,
that their partner was alive.
Yeah, they found their friends alive, huh?
It's just phenomenal. It's just, you know, people coming in that were trapped in the building for a while and then coming in and being cleaned up, and then finally someone who was also trapped but got out had no idea
that their partner was alive or dead, and then seeing them over here was just spectacular.
All right, thanks a lot, Bob.
Thanks, Bob.
Okay.
All kinds of stories today, Fez. We were talking about that.
Yeah, right now Mayor Giuliani is speaking, and he's actually bringing in some city officials.
Let's throw that to them. We'll be back, 877-692-1027, and let's listen to what the mayor has to say.
All right, this is the mayor and, of course, some other city officials that are speaking now. All right, that is Mayor Giuliani's press conference going on now.
And you can pick that up on 1010 Winds if you want to keep on listening to the mayor. We wanted to open the phones back up and let some people just talk about their day today. Most of the radio stations are carrying news, if you'd like to switch over to them. Also, most of the TV stations are going to be straight news. I guess for some time, Fuzzy. I think it'll be some time before you start seeing regular television again.
Right, so as all sorts of news coverage is available to you, we're going to give you the opportunity to just express how you feel on our phone lines, 877-692-1027.
Hey, Michelle, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Ron. Hey, Fez. How are you guys?
Hey, honey.
I'm calling for a few reasons. The first was I have three friends of mine who are New York cops who went in with the first wave before the buildings collapsed. We haven't heard anything yet. They're saying that that first wave who went in is most likely decimated, cops, firefighters, and anyone else who is in there. And I live in Patterson, and there's a lot of tension going on there right now, you know. I mean, I saw people out and out cheering in the streets, and I saw a lot of fighting going on. And please, just to get it out to people, don't do anything but pray for the family and friends of people who are lost in there, because they're going to need that a lot more than you need to beat the crap out of somebody.
Thank you very much, Michelle.
And also, I want to know how they got that close to the Pentagon and nobody caught it. I don't understand.
We'll have to find that out over the next several days.
One of several answers we're looking for, and thank you for the Leo Sayer in the background.
Yeah.
You don't get to hear a lot of Leo Sayer anymore.
Hey, Chris, you're on Ron and Fez.
Was that When I Need Love in the background?
Yeah, it was When I Need Love. Yeah,
I could hear that faintly. Listen, I'm looking on a free website here, newyork.com.
Yeah.
It says a passenger on Airlines Flight 93 called in on his cell phone, locked in a bathroom, and delivered a chilling message. "We're being hijacked," it says in quotes. "We're being hijacked." Minutes later, the jetliner crashed down in western Pennsylvania with 45 people aboard. The last of four closely timed terrorist attacks. And then it says further down, it says, "The man told dispatchers the plane was going down. I heard some sort of explosion," the man says, who got the phone call. His name was Kramer. "I heard some sort of explosion. I saw white smoke coming from the plane, and we lost contact with him."
Yeah, I heard about that. I heard about that story earlier today. We don't know what happened on that flight in Pennsylvania, Fez.
Yeah, we no idea really where, if that was part of the plan, part of the plot, it was headed towards.
Yeah, it had to have been part of the plot.
Well, they said that that plane was going towards Camp David.
Yeah.
Originally.
Oh, okay.
Now, one of the, thanks for calling, one of the other many theories out there, along with the, you know, timeless 9/11 ones, was that this is 25 years to the day since the Camp David agreement during the Carter years.
Oh, with President Carter and Anwar Sadat and Menachem Begin.
Yeah. So who knows? We'll have to wait until all that stuff comes out, what exactly happened. I know everybody would like the answers tonight. I know everybody would like to know what the president plans on doing, or why this happened, or what we can do to keep this from happening. The fact of the matter is that we're trying to come to grips with tonight is that it did happen.
Mm-hmm.
It happened. Our city literally was attacked from the air.
Happened right here in New York, and just, it's devastating. Absolutely devastating to a city.
I don't think any of us are going to forget this one. It's here's a young man, Fez, he wants to talk to us. It's Mike, he's 13 years old. Hey, Mike, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, Mike, go ahead, buddy.
Hi, Ron Fez?
Yeah, buddy.
I was in school today around 9 o'clock the time it happened, and it was just devastating. The way it happened at 9 o'clock, and we got told at, like, 12.
Uh-huh.
and everyone was like crying and stuff, and I know someone whose mom works near there, and he got a call later on in the day saying his mom was fine, and he was all like crying and happy and stuff.
Yeah, right.
And my dad was in the original, the first World Trade bombing.
Yeah.
And I remember that I was like 4 or something, and he was telling me about that a while back, and now I know what it must have, I don't know what it must have felt like, but I know how other people felt, how my mom felt when she heard about the bombing.
Okay, Mikey. Thanks for calling, pal.
Thanks, bud.
All right. Thanks for telling us that, Mike.
So many of these young kids is going to stay with them for the rest of their life. Here's another one, Fez. Jason, he's 13 years old. Jason, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, Jason.
Hey, guys.
Yeah,
my school's right down the Hudson. You can see right down the Hudson from New York City. You can see it from our school.
Uh-huh.
And there must have been 20 kids whose parents worked in or right around the World Trade Center. And the father of one of the girls in my town was actually on the first plane that crashed into the building.
Is that right, buddy?
Yeah. My friend's uncle was in the building and had just walked out when the first plane hit, and got out just in time with some of his coworkers. And when the first plane hit, the building that got hit came over the speaker and said it was the other one that had been hit. Everybody stay inside and don't move. And people did stay inside, and they thought it was the other building. And
okay, pal.
All right, thanks.
Thanks for calling us, buddy.
All right.
There's a couple of young people, Fezzy.
Yeah.
13 years old. I mean, we can't, fathom all this stuff, and we're adults.
Mm-hmm. And they are trying to make any sort of sense out of it, and if ever.
Yeah. Josh, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, Josh.
Hey, guys.
Yeah.
My roommate, I'm in high school, 17. My roommate's dad, went away at boarding school, and his dad is in, the building. I've been up to his office, had lunch with him a couple of weeks ago. And, 90th floor or something.
Yeah.
And I think it was in the first building that got hit. And, they haven't heard anything. And it's just, I just can't imagine somebody in my family, not knowing, just that uncertainty, looming for all those thousands of families.
Yeah.
Just out there, I've already cried my eyes out, and everybody I know has, them. And it's just so tough, and for people to be acting, violently, and just acting so stupidly when this is really a time where everybody needs to come together and support each other. It's just really offensive.
Thank you, Josh.
Yeah.
We were talking with Jimmy the cop earlier, Fezzy. You said some of the numbers that we have of police and firefighters that are missing right now as high as 1,500, which is, how do you even think about that? But you're talking about that's how many families are out there at a minimum, desperately wondering, and I'm afraid that these numbers are going to be so much higher than that, but desperately worried about people and their family.
Yeah, Jimmy the cop said they were organizing a lot of the guys. He's part of the next wave to head into South Manhattan when they decide to do that. And right now, just trying to get together some sort of head count.
Right.
And see, who's missing from what precinct and what group.
Hey, Jay. Jay, you're on Ron FS. How you doing, buddy?
Hi, Jay.
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Yeah.
My wife and I had our third child this morning at about 8:19, about a good half hour right before all this happened. And obviously, we knew nothing about it, and we come out, and my wife goes into recovery, and I was getting changed to go down and sit with her. And, you just see, pandemonium in the hospital, and this is on Long Island. And just people running around and crying, and it's just, I consider myself to be like one of those guys who doesn't get really affected and stuff. And when I saw that tower go down, I just got like this wave, this chill over me. It was pretty uncomfortable.
Right.
And I'm sure you guys did too. And the only comfort in the day, and some, I saw six babies come into the world today in that hospital. So if anybody's listening, that, you know, life does go on, and it sucks that all those people had to go and everything. But
you know, for me, I had the strangest thing, because I literally don't think I felt a single thing until I got my kids, when I had to go run into their schools, you know, and it was a numbing feeling.
I pick my kids up from school. You know, I have a 5-year-old who's in kindergarten. He goes half day. And when my 8-year-old got home, he told me that half the kids in the class got picked up early. Parents were just coming in picking up their kids like crazy today.
Odd day for you, Jay.
That's in Long Island, right? Half the parents were picking up their kids.
Out of Long Island.
Odd day for you, Jay, where you should be, you have every right to feel ecstatic. You got a new baby, and then, you know, you try to match that up against what else went on today.
Yeah, it's weird. You know, you call family and friends, and you try to get, you know, everybody's excited, but they're so taken back by what's going on TV, it's difficult for them to get excited. So,
thank you, Jay.
Thanks, guys.
All right. 877-692-1027 is the Ron and Fez show on 102.7 WNEW. I guess you probably noticed all the shows today not running any commercials, just staying open and doing the only thing we know how to do over here, and that's just yap.
Yeah, and taking your calls, knowing that everyone out there has a range of emotions, and if you want to vent a little, you want to share a little, we're right here for you. Right, I said the phone number, 877-692-1027.
Frankly, Fez, I expect you know, those of us who feel one way tonight to feel a different way tomorrow, maybe a different way the day after that. I'm sure a lot of these younger kids are going to have to go through all different kinds of stuff just to feel safe in their own country. You know, I mean, for us, we feel like this is a local story, but our country has been, you know, we feel like our neighborhood's been attacked. Our country's been attacked.
Yeah. The entire country's got to feel where, and no matter where you're at in the country, you know, you looked up in the sky today, you didn't see any airplanes going by.
That's bizarre.
You know, I'm sure.
Did you ever recall another day like that for any circumstances in your lifetime?
Not that I can remember. So just an eerie feeling across the entire country, as I'm sure no matter what city you were in, roads were cleared out because nobody knew who was next on the list.
Right. Of course, there were some planes flying today, Fezzy, and that was those military planes flying around New York.
That was so weird.
F-14s, F-16s, what were they?
I've heard both.
the strangeness of that, of knowing that they're there to protect us. We're suddenly in that no-fly zone. It's us.
Yeah.
We're not watching it on CNN anymore. It's us. It's our life. Hey, Teresa. Teresa, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hi, Teresa.
Hi. How are you guys?
We're hanging in there. How are you, honey?
Hanging in there the same way. Am I on the radio now?
Yes, you are.
You're live.
Okay. I'm calling to comment on the gentleman who called previously. And up until this point of today, I have never been so infuriated in my life that he feels, I don't know what country he's from, but he feels we should let it go. I mean, we were at work today. I work in Teaneck, New Jersey. And we could see the Twin Towers from where I work. And our company deals with all New York companies. We have people from our company over there that we couldn't get a hold of. We don't know if they're dead or alive. We have people whose children who are adults that work in the Twin Towers. They couldn't get a hold of them. We have somebody else who has a nephew that works in the Pentagon. She couldn't get a hold of him. Our office was sheer chaos. We leave. I go pick up my son from school. My son's 8 years old. He comes home. He sees this on TV all day and turns around and looks at me and says, Mommy, are they going to come to New Jersey and do that here? I mean, where is this guy living that he feels that we should just let it go? We've done this to enough other people. When have we ever, ever done anything so drastic or cruel or inhumane for no reason besides protecting ourselves?
Okay, Teresa, thanks for calling us, honey.
Okay, thank you.
Right, bye-bye.
Thank bye-bye.
Here's Jimmy. Jimmy, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, Jimmy.
Hey, how we doing, fellas?
Hey, pal.
My brother's a firefighter out of Ladder 115 in Long Island City. And I called him today around 10 o'clock. And he said he got called in. I talked to him about 6 o'clock, and he just got back from the city. And if you recall Saving Private Ryan at the end, he was saying that downtown, the scene in the movie was a garden compared to what the city looks like.
I can't imagine the way we're all going to be changed by what happened from the situation. But especially the amount of lives that we lost over this.
So many lives, so many people involved, when the rescue effort that went in there, and those people that were lost, the amount of people that work in those buildings, it's going to be hard not to find someone who isn't touched by this in some way, that didn't have some sort of connection to it.
It's just brutal, man. And I think we all, whether we're all, you know, black, white, whatever, we all need to come together, man. We all need to, we need to show the people in the rest of this world that, you know, even sisters and brothers fight amongst themselves, but we have to show them that even though we have our own problems in this country, that we are the best. We can come together and we can defeat this.
Thank you very much, Jimmy.
All right, take care, bro.
Here's a friend of ours, Fezzi. It's Johnny from Hard Rock Cafe. It's Hard Rock Johnny. How you doing there, Johnny? Welcome to Ron and Fez.
Hey, John.
Hey, boys. How are you?
Hanging in there, pal.
That's all we can do. It's, you know, I was there this morning for work, and, you know, we close. We don't really, you know, that's not even what it's about. It's just watching people walk around that city at 11 and 11:30 this morning. It was just zombies, and it was just so surreal. It was just like a scene from a bad movie.
It really was, and I was out on the streets at that time. And very, very bizarre looks on everybody's faces.
Just, no one knew what to do, and it's like you said, you'd never know. It's going to be impossible for someone who lives up here not to know somebody.
Yeah,
and I was watching TV, and it showed a guy. I know a person who was in one of the airplanes that crashed. I mean, and it's just bizarre that, like, they announced his name because he was a hockey guy from years back that I knew. And I knew him, and it's just like, you know, that's the beginning of it. There's going to be so many more people that people know if you work in the city or live around here.
Right.
It's like a bad dream. You open tomorrow, when you wake up, it's all gone. And unfortunately, it's not going to be.
No, it's going to go on. It's going to go on, my friend.
When I was walking around in my neighborhood, the people that were out on the street, you know, like you said, Johnny, just wandering, they looked like they were just looking to latch on to anybody else that happened to be out there. Everyone that was out there walking along was looking for someone else to cling to. And people's eyes were meeting and conversations were starting.
And that's not usually what happens in the city, unfortunately. People are just in a rush and they're in a hurry. Yeah. They don't want to talk to anybody. But people just needed other people. They needed people to talk to and know that, hey, you're not alone. And it's just, it's really, really tough things that we're all going to have to, and it's going to take weeks and months. And, I mean, today, really, I think, and I mean, I'm not the only one who said this, I'm not so impondent, but today changed, today from this day forward, our world has changed. The way that we live, the way that everything goes every day has changed from this day forward. And it's a shame, and it's there's just going to have to, there's just no end to it, it seems.
Thank you so much, Johnny.
Thanks, guys.
All right, buddy.
We'll talk to you later, pal.
Good work. See ya.
Thanks, Johnny. Yeah, Johnny mentioned the people from the L.A. Kings hockey team. What that was is two scouts, Ronnie.
Yeah.
Two hockey scouts.
But they were old pros, right?
Yeah, Garnet Ace Bailey, who actually played with Wayne Gretzky at one point, and Mark Bavis.
Also, I had heard, I think the Boston to L.A. flight had one of the co-producers of the Frasier show. I had heard that earlier today and then didn't hear it again. Somebody that was coming in from either Cape Cod or Martha's Vineyard taking that trip from Boston to L.A. So, like we said, you're going to... I don't know whether we've ever had a situation where we lost that many people in four different plane accidents in the same day. That would have been astronomical. Somebody attacking the Pentagon like that.
Sure.
Would have been astronomical. All those stories kind of footnotes with what happened here in New York City.
Yeah, you see on a normal news day, if there's a plane crash, that always takes you back a little bit. And you think, ugh, yikes, plane crash. And now, four of them in one day, plus everything else that goes involved with it. knowing they're premeditated.
Chris, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hi, Chris.
Hey, how you doing, guys? I'm just calling because this morning I went in and found out that my boss's wife was on one of the towers, and he had just talked to her on her cell phone right after the plane hit. And, you know, I was just saying what I was trying to do today and for everybody is just to try and help the people who don't know, because since then he hasn't heard from her, and we don't know what's going on. And it's just kind of like you just got to be there for people.
We got a phone number for you here. Here's 1-800-331-0075. It's a toll-free number for information on victims, families, and survivors. Yeah. 1-800-331-0075.
Yeah.
You know, Chris, my heart goes out to all those kind of stories. I don't know how there's countless amount of those stories tonight.
Yeah, I'm just saying, like, everybody, like, to the next 2 days is supposed to be my days off. I'm going to be there from day to night, all day at work, because, you know, he's not going to, you know, you got to do whatever you can for the people who don't know. You know, you just go out of your way. If you don't have somebody that you've lost, then, you know, you'll probably know somebody that does. And just, you know, best thing you can do is just help them however you can.
All right, thanks a lot there,
Chris. Thank you, guys.
All right, see you later, buddy.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, Chris. Earl, you're helping us out tonight. Did you see some numbers from the Pentagon bombing?
It said it was up to 800 at the Pentagon.
800 at the Pentagon.
Up to 800 killed at the Pentagon, 100 to 800 missing.
And they said 250 firefighters were crushed when it collapsed.
At the Pentagon, okay.
So those are numbers that we're getting from the news. And I think right now up to 800 dead at the Pentagon bombing.
Astronomical numbers. Just phenomenal numbers, Fezia. And these are the only kind of numbers you see like this happen in times of war. No other time.
Right. And those Pentagon numbers can double with the amount of people that are presumed missing right now.
Laszlo, you're on the Ron Fez show.
Hey,
Laszlo.
Hey, I'm actually down in Virginia. My brother's a firefighter down here. I'm part of the late night shift. And I've continued to be a fan. The first time I've called since you switched that late night time slot.
Right.
But actually, I think the numbers are a little off on the Pentagon for what you have from what we're getting down here. Plus, actually, the main part where it hit the Pentagon was kind of, they were redoing that part, so it could have been a lot worse, because it wasn't nearly as populated.
All right, hold on, let me check. Earl, where'd you get your numbers from?
That was according to CNN.
That was CNN numbers he just got there. What do you have, Laszlo?
I don't know, but it's not near that high from just what the local stuff is around here.
Okay.
And, you know, we're feeling it down here, but our hearts and prayers go out to everyone up in New York, and, you know, this is a terrible reason to call, but you know, we feel like, you know, you're part of our community down here, and, you know, we're just with you, and, you know, sorry that this had to happen.
Laszlo, thanks so much for calling us, buddy.
Yeah, peace out, guys.
All right.
Appreciate it, Laszlo.
The Ron and Fez show reruns late nights in Washington, D.C. on WJFK.
Right.
And so I guess he called this early here. It's stunning night all the way around. And, you know, we're talking about some of these numbers. I hate to even give them out.
Yeah.
You know, if you really are interested in a lot of these different numbers, I'd go to 1010 Wins or CNN on television or just about anybody else but us. We're only going to be given occasional updates. We thought that we would just kick in a little bit by opening up our phone lines and just letting people share their feelings and their stories here tonight.
So you want to express yourself, 877-692-1027.
Larry, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Yeah, hi, my name is Larry. I'm from New Jersey.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Larry.
This day is just unbelievable. I mean, I've been, like, really angry all day about this. I have a friend that actually worked there and got out safely. God, thankful. But, you know, I don't want to sound like a hate monger, but when will we show these countries we mean business? I mean, we bomb them, they come back and do the same thing. We embargo them, they come back and do the same thing. I mean, where do we draw the line? I mean, I'm angry now.
I understand it, Larry.
It's just like, I can't understand this. I mean, you know, I good and bad in every culture or whatever, but, you know, the bad's starting to outweigh the good here. You know?
Larry, thanks for calling us, okay, pal?
Thanks.
All right, see ya. Of course we're going to have anger, Fezzy.
Sure. and we're going to let you vent.
And if we knew who to blame, we'd tell you right away. We're basically going to wait and see what the president has to say, what the Pentagon has to say. Here's, let me go to a young guy here, 14 years old. His name's Pete. Pete, you're on Iran and Fez. How you doing, buddy?
Hey, Ron. Hey, Fez.
Yeah.
I live, like, about 40 minutes away from the city.
Uh-huh.
And today at school, it was, it still affected everybody. And I felt, like, such a wide range of emotions today. I mean, like my aunt works in Midtown, so I was really worried about that. Like, there was kids, the teachers were telling some of the kids that their parents were fine. They called in, and then I'd see other kids just be called up by the guidance counselor or something, and that's just really stuck something into my side and just makes me hurt, you know what I mean?
Sure, yeah.
And also today towards the end of the day, the other emotion I felt was this kid walking down the hall. I heard two other kids talking saying, yeah, it's kind of funny actually that this happened. And I just blew up at the kid. He was lucky he was walking down the hall because I probably would have just done something I would have regretted. And I don't know, it's just a real tragedy. But on the thing about the Pittsburgh plane,
yeah,
I kind of have like just my own thoughts about it. I think maybe because the terrorists were gonna use it, I think, for something. I think that either we shot it down because we knew it was gonna go destroy something, or maybe the pilot crashed it himself just to save lives, you know what I mean?
I thought the same thing, Pete, that it might have been a situation where a pilot just said, eat dirt, but, well, I guess, you know, they're going to check the black boxes and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And figure out what happened in all these cases. It's going to take some time. Pete, 14 years old, mature guy, okay, buddy?
All right, God bless.
Thanks
America.
A lot.
God right, bless
Pete.
You guys.
All right, see you later.
All right, bye.
And yes, there's going to be knuckleheads out there that want to laugh and want to scream things, and everyone's looking for their own way through this.
Here's Michelle. Michelle, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, Michelle. Right.
Thanks for calling, honey. Here's, let's see what we got here. Hold on. Here's Hosh. Is that his name? Hosh, you're on Ron and Fez?
Hosh?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Hi, how you doing?
What can we do for you?
Well, I just wanted to let you know that I live in Kearney here. We're right across the river from there. We've been watching it all day. I mean, I saw the second one go down in person. But right now, out in my street, on my main drag out there, they're all out with the American flags. They're all the bars, they're all out in front of the bars. They're all waving their flags, making people blow their horns. This is getting a little scary at this point. I mean, I think they're going to start to retaliate here. It's like right within our city. This is starting to look really weird. You got to see this.
All right, Hosh. It was a very, very strange day. And
it's going to bring more strange times.
People are going to react in a million different ways. It's 877-692-1027. Here's Howard. He says he's in the National Guard Fest. Howard, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Ron Fez?
Yeah.
Hey, Howard.
Hey, how's it going? This has been a weird day. Yeah, I work with the National Guard over in Orangeburg. We run a signal battalion, and this has been like, even the guys from there, they're like, this is sick. I mean, we got like, I was working earlier this morning, and all of a sudden, I hear like, you know, a plane hit the World Trade Center. I'm thinking it's like this little Cessna thing. Next thing I know, I get home, I'm getting called out because we got to like, send a whole bunch of people out there, get communication systems and set up for all the people, MPs down there, and like I get home and there's two things in the ground, they're gone,
right?
Completely gone.
Now, Howard, what's the next step for you being in the National Guard?
I don't know, cause I haven't been to any really training yet, so I'm just going around helping out by our main base over here in Orangeburg. But I mean, we got guys, we're going down there, we're basically like a phone company for everybody, because so all their communications are probably knocked out, getting power to them, helping out, moving out, like, rescue people out of there, create some maybe order around with some of the MPs and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, you know, it's a whole lot of work that we've got to get done.
All right, be careful, Howard.
All right, thanks.
All right, thanks a lot. We, just leaving the phone lines open tonight on the Ron and Fez show, taking your stories, your experiences. If you're looking for hard news, best to go to 1010 Winds or any of the CNN channels, Fez. But we'll hang in and take some more of your calls. Here's Kyle. Kyle, you're on Run of Fez. Hi, Kyle.
Hi, guys. I just wanted to share a story about how truly bad it was.
Okay.
One of my mom's really good friends, her son called her from the 108th floor of the second building to be hit. And he had to tell his own mom that he wouldn't survive and that there was no way he could get out of the building and that he loved her and that he would never see her again.
That is rough, Kyle.
Kyle, how old is he?
He was 22.
22 years old, Fez.
He's 22, and he will never see his own mother again.
Thanks for calling us, buddy.
All right, no problem. Bye.
That add so much horror to an already horrible situation, knowing that all those things were going on today. How many of those things haven't we heard yet that went on inside that building, both those buildings?
Shannon, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hi, Shannon.
Yeah, Ron and Fez?
Yeah, go ahead, pal.
Yeah, how you doing? In a word, it's just very surreal. This whole thing, this understatement, you know, just hearing all the stories and so forth. But I'm actually listening to you and watching the TV, and now how everybody was saying, with this happening, what's next? When they shut down the George Washington Bridge, the CBS is now reporting that they found a truckload of explosives under the bridge. They just stopped it. It's breaking news as we speak right now.
All right, we'll have our people check on that. CBS is reporting, according to Shannon, that a truckload of explosives was found near the George Washington Bridge.
Yeah, it's breaking news as we speak right now.
All right, Billy and Hawk, check that one out for us on CBS or with 1010 Winds.
See what you can find out for us.
It would not have surprised me at all. Not surprised me at all, Fezzy. This thing was very, very well planned out.
Yeah, everything they pulled off today, you know, there's no reason to think that there wasn't other things that they tried that did get stopped.
Here is Tom. Tom, you're on Ron and Fez. How you doing, buddy?
Hey, Tom.
Hey, what's going on?
What's going on with you, buddy?
I've been listening to you guys like for a year and a half now since the beginning, you know? And you guys usually go through your regular thing and everything, and most of the news stations are doing that now. And I think what you're doing is, like, really great, you know what I'm saying? You're just letting people vent out their feelings.
Well, anything you want to talk about, Tom?
Yeah, I wanted to say, I live in Yonkers, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I go to school in the Bronx. I go to Fordham Prep. I'm a sophomore. I'm 14 years old. And I'm saying, right, I went to school today, and first period, fine, you know, everything's great, everything's going good, it's just a regular day. Then second period, I'm just sitting there, second period, and, like, in the middle of the class, there's this announcement, and it says something's crashed into the World Trade Center, and, you know, everyone's okay right now, but you know, we don't know what's going to happen, right? And we all thought, yeah, whatever, some... Everybody's okay, everybody's fine, whatever. I walk into third period, and my teacher sits there, and he starts to try to explain, like, how immense the situation is, like, what's going on. Like, we're in a school in the Bronx, right? We get on the roof, and we could see the smoke, you know what I'm saying?
Sure.
It was like, and you just, sometimes I can't believe that this is, like, really happening. Like, where do you think you're going to hear the words, America has been attacked? You know what I mean? Like,
it's been.
Where else are you going to hear that?
Yeah, it's been since what, Fez? Pearl Harbor?
Yeah.
Yeah, like
before
Pearl
that,
Harbor, you know what
the Civil,
like,
War.
How often do you hear that? Like, America has been attacked. Attack on America. And I feel right now, I feel like for the first time in a little bit, like, I feel kind of glad that Bush is president right now, because number one, nobody else would be want to stuck in that situation right now. And number two, he's kind of like this redneck kind of guy, so he's probably going to get real mad, like, real easy. And
all right, thank you, Tom.
All right, later.
All right, see you later.
All right, Tom.
Tom's a young man who...
Stone Cold George Bush is going to take care of this.
Well, George W. Bush, Fezzy, is... what's that statement? Some men are born to greatness, some have greatness thrusted
upon them.
Well, this is the situation our president is in right now. He's,
he just got thrusted.
He's gone from kind of coming in to a very, you know, a very, very strange election.
Right.
That got him in here.
And then under the radar for quite a while.
Under the radar, almost seems like purposely up to this point.
Uh-huh.
And now... the entire country is looking to him and say, what now? And this is his time to shine.
His initial speech today in Sarasota, Florida, where he surrounded with school children, where he was reading to an elementary school class, pushing his education plan, he's surrounded by little kids as he's saying, we will hunt you down. And then on to Louisiana, where he taped some statements. And then Omaha, Nebraska, and finally back to Washington, where he made his speech tonight.
His speech tonight, somewhat subdued. Earl, you got something for us, buddy?
No, I was listening about Channel 2 report. They have confirmed that they found explosives out under the GWB.
Unbelievable.
Wow.
It's the George Washington Bridge, of course. Very, very strange story.
Amazing that it's... when we said, you know, when things kept getting bombed and planes flown into, you wondered when it was going to be over. Now you're finding out more things like this.
Bill, you may want to print in the future or type it up. Fezzy, look what he hands me.
Well,
look at that.
Oh, nice.
It's like someone handed me a slinky.
Hey, Cleopatra. A nice hieroglyphic.
I honestly didn't plan for it to be a note. I thought I was just going to tell you.
Obviously, you didn't plan on it being English.
Billy just handed this to me. Tom, you're on the Ron and Fez show. Tommy.
Hey, what's up, guys?
Hey, go ahead, Tom.
Yeah, I work for the phone company, but I won't say in what capacity, but... there's executives that have to go down to that Verizon building down there.
Uh-huh.
The one that, right, you can see on the TV, the old building right next to the ones that fell.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And one of the top executives there said, whatever they're saying on TV, is you can't even imagine how much worse it is. It's just even worse than what you could even imagine seeing on TV and everything they're showing. It's that much worse. And there was two guys that they arrested under the bridge with that truck, by the way. I don't know if you got that or not.
Now, this just happened tonight that they arrested them?
Yeah, it just happened a while ago. They got two guys.
Okay, so it wasn't just an abandoned truck.
No, they got two guys in custody, they said. Just to let you know. Have a good one, guys.
All right,
doing a great job. Thanks.
Thank you, buddy.
Bye.
All right, if you want to call in and let us know how you're feeling, because that's what we're doing tonight, 877-692-1027.
Hey, James. James, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hi, James.
Hey, Ron and Fez. How's it going?
Hey.
I don't even know where to start. This is amazing. I basically called up just to show my support for President Bush. I can't honestly say I was for the man since the start of the election. I couldn't honestly say as far as his policy I was with him now. But after hearing his speech this afternoon, I was never more proud to be an American.
Well,
23 years old. I'm halfway through my enlistment process into the Navy, and I can't wait now.
James, thanks a lot for calling us, buddy.
God bless America.
Sick. A lot of people are going to be feeling that way, and even Senator Hillary Clinton, Fezzy, said almost the same exact thing. I'm with the president no matter what. Let's rock this thing. We're all together now. There is times to disagree with each other and be political, but it surely isn't one of those times right now.
Yeah, Senator Clinton said that tonight. Former President Clinton said that earlier. Former President Jimmy Carter came out, said pretty much the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Who's always looking for a microphone?
Mark, you're on Ron and Fez. How you doing?
Hi, Mark.
Yeah, hey, what's up?
What's going on with you, Mark?
Yeah, I don't know. I think if the president was in the White House, they would have shut every one of those planes down in about 5 seconds. It takes what? It doesn't take 30 minutes to get from Boston to New York. They knew those planes were coming. They just were like, oh, you know, some ass in NORAD was like, oh, the president's in Florida. What are these guys doing? And New York suffered. They had time to blow these planes down. They watched it happen.
Mark, You know, I don't know what that whole situation would be. I know that you're pretty angry right now.
Well, I'm not really angry, but if the president was in, if these planes were heading for Florida, they would have shot him down then, too. I'm just saying, you know, I feel kind of expendable at the moment.
Well,
I mean, the president wasn't in New York.
Well, if he was in the White House when those planes took out of Virginia or Pennsylvania, especially those planes, what they did was they turned down from Boston. They were heading right for the White House. Some guy was probably thinking, all right, they're heading for the Capitol. They didn't think they were going to stop in New York. And they were just assumed the worst. And
You don't know all that, Mark, but thank you for calling us. We don't know what exactly took place between the tower and those planes, Fezzi, whether they were, in contact with those planes at all. But normally when you have a hostage situation, I don't think the first thing to do is to blow the plane out of the sky.
Right. When you have a plane that's been taken over, you would hope to have some sort of happy ending where you could negotiate and bring that plane in for a landing somewhere.
And we don't know whether they talked to him, whether they didn't.
We don't know the status of the crew once the hijackings took place.
So many of these stories that we'll have to work out in the next couple of weeks. Hey, Bob, you're on Ron FS.
Hi, Bob.
Hey, how's it going?
Yeah.
I was speaking with family member, and they have Route 3 closed at Giant Stadium. They have they're like 99% sure they have a bomb in front of the Metro Media building across the street from it.
And where are you getting this from, Bob?
I have a family member, a local fireman,
mm-hmm.
involved with the scene.
All right, thanks a lot, Bob. We'll check on that, okay?
Yeah, if you want to check on it.
All right, thanks a lot, pal.
You're welcome.
So we're getting more of these kind of reports, Fezzi, coming in now.
Right. Major League Baseball, of course, shut down for tonight. And no word, I haven't heard any on the NFL or college football this weekend.
Hey, Sherry, you're on the Ron FS show.
Hi, Sherry.
Hey, guys. How you doing?
We're hanging in there, babe.
I actually called earlier to talk about something else, but I just found out a little while ago a friend of my daughter's called to say that both of her parents were killed in the World Trade Center today. Or feared missing.
How old is she, honey?
She's 12.
And both her parents worked there?
Yeah. And they're unaccounted for.
I think a lot of those stories are going to be coming in over the next several days also.
Yeah,
sure.
I mean, we live in a little safe suburban area in Bergen County, and, you know, the tragedy transcends all areas.
Yes, it does, honey.
Yep.
So sad.
All right. Yeah, it's horrible.
All right, thanks a lot, Bob.
I love you guys.
Thanks, Sherry.
Bye-bye.
Earl's in here with us.
Earl, what update you got for us?
So Police Commissioner Carrick has said will not confirm a report that there was explosives on either the GWB or the Lincoln Tunnel.
So he hasn't talked about either situation.
He has not confirmed that.
Okay. And obviously no confirmation on Giant Stadium.
No.
All right. Speaking of the football, the NFL said, regarding Sunday's games, we will make no decisions today. We will gather information and speak to several parties in the next 24 to 48 hours.
On the NFL games? Or
on the NFL.
Yeah, I don't think we'll have any NFL games this weekend, Fezzi, because as we were talking about earlier, it's going to take a couple of days for this to get into the nation's psyche. If we've seen this kind of thing before. And today, you're basically looking at a stone country. Billy, you got an update for us?
Yes, I do. The police commissioner of New York just announced that all of Manhattan will be closed south of 14th Street from the Hudson to the East River to all non-essential traffic. So only emergency vehicles only. Any civilian vehicles will be stopped and you'll be arrested.
Is that for tomorrow as well as tonight?
As of right now.
Okay.
All right, that's 14th Street south.
Anything south of 14th Street from the Hudson to the East River.
Okay.
So, in other words, any civilian vehicle, you'll be arrested and impounded. And they also have said that CBS is reporting that there was a van stopped on the George Washington Bridge with enough explosives in it to take the whole bridge down. The police commissioner from New York did confirm that there was a stoppage. He doesn't have any other information on it, but CBS is reporting that they did. The Port Authority police did pull over a van on the bridge loaded with explosives.
Okay.
Thanks a lot, Billy. Newsman Billy Staples says he.
That's our cub reporter.
Billy came into. Billy, come back in here for a second.
Our pub reporter.
And Billy came in from Long Island today. Tell everybody how you got to the station.
Oh, I took the train.
Well, how'd you do that?
Well, the trains were only. I live out on the islands. These trains were only stopping at Jamaica. And all non-emergency personnel had to get off at Jamaica. And I'm not considered emergency personnel, so I hid in the bathroom until we got to Penn Station.
Wow. So the train just completely emptied out and you went in the bathroom?
Yeah, the only people who were on the train were Long Island Railroad employees and a couple other guys in nondescript clothing. You know, but then I just went into the little tiny bathrooms they have on the train. I shut the door. No one's going to look in there.
Right.
It's only about a 10-minute ride from Jamaica to Penn Station. No one checked. Okay. And then when they got into Penn, all the doors opened up, and I just walked right out.
Did you use that time to go to the bathroom at all? Or
heck
you
no.
Just stood there?
No. I've seen the people who go in those bathrooms.
So you can hold your breath for 10 minutes.
I think I set some kind of record in there, to be honest with you.
Thank you. Billy Staples with us tonight as well. The Hawk.
Way to go to get in here. I know you impressed the GM and the PD.
The Hawk walked over the Queensboro Bridge. Here's Lola. Lola, you're on Ronifez.
Hi, Lola.
You know, it feels so weird because usually I call up to joke around.
Yeah.
And like last week, it was my son's football team that was in the highlight of the news. And this morning, I mean, he just started college a week ago. And this morning, he, after watching the explosions and everything, he said, you know, Mom, if they're going to have a thing to sign up, I'm going to sign up to join the service. And I just, you know, I was so proud of him at that moment. And it just, like, puts things in perspective that something so silly like a stripper, you know, that kids get ridiculed for, and then the next week they could be going out to fight for their country. And anyway, that's all I wanted to say.
Thank you, honey.
I'm not joking around today.
All right, bye-bye. All right.
Bye.
Good. Thank you, Lola.
I don't find it much funny last week.
No.
I
don't recall her.
Yeah, I remember. I remember. Billy Staples had a little thing for her.
Ah.
Is this AV, Fez, would you say? Avi? Online text?
I would say Avi.
All right. Well, Avi. Avi, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hello?
Yes.
I'm on the air right now.
Is this fake impression?
All right. What I wanted to say is earlier, somebody spoke about the motive of this suicide bomber have. And from what I know, I'm an Israeli. What I heard is this: they have this education that it doesn't matter what's the target. It doesn't matter what they do. The most important thing for them is to just commit suicide, because in their religion, it says that if they're going to do it, they're going to be shaheed. And Shahid gets 77 blonde women in the next world.
I've heard that before, Fezzi. I never understood that whole situation that supposedly if you die in this kind of heroic way to them, you get chicks in the next world. I never understood
that. You get blonde women?
Yeah.
You get 77 blonde to serve you in the next world. That's what they have in their... The babies, that's what they teach them.
Uh-huh.
So,
the blonde women part just sounds odd to me, because that doesn't seem like it would be women from that part of the country.
Well, I don't know.
Swedes.
I don't know what part and what not part. But
so this is actually part of their religion.
That's part
the
of
Lutheran
what they,
religion.
That's the education they have.
Yeah.
That's the motive that they have in their mind. I mean, what possibly normal person will do, drive an airplane to some buildings? I mean, this is, he cannot explain it.
No, I can't understand it, no matter how long it was explained to me, why somebody would be part of one of these suicide missions. So.
Yes, and it's like the same thing. Well, why somebody will go to a mall in Israel and then just bomb himself the same way?
Yeah, right.
And then what I know, what they tell me about this, this is what they learn in schools. It's coming from these kids. That they're learning in their schools that if you die over this suicide bombing, you're going to be a hero. You're going to be somebody all your family will be proud of you, and the family will have a good life, and you have this woman in the next life.
Now, you growing up in Israel, I guess you've seen a lot of this kind of terrorist actions against your country, huh?
Well, of course, I have experience with this, but I tell you something. With all the experience I have and the newspaper I read in Hebrew, such thing that happened today, it's nothing. It's what happened today, it's something so big that is what happened in Israel is nothing compared to what happened here today. It's what I read when I read the Israeli newspaper today with a few people die, and I felt like it's a small change for what happened today. It's like a tremendous thing, and people cannot understand why this thing happened. It's not because America took, and the guy before said that because America was killing somebody in Kuwait,
right,
or something.
Right.
This is nonsense, because this has nothing to do with that. Some people wake up in the morning and they have this fundamental religion in their mind. That's how they learn it in the school, and then they have this pray every Friday, and that's what they hear from their teachers. They hear that if you kill and you die over it, you're going to be a hero. You're going to be somebody that is going to be worth it for you. And the only way to fight it is to organize all the countries that have the modern country in the world to show them that terrorist is not something that's going to win at the end. It's going to lose. And then the funniest thing is that American government give money to the Hezbollah. They give money to this organization. And the American taxpayer pay. They pay with their own money to get this mess, this chaos. How can you understand this?
Thank you for calling, my friend.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thanks for your insight, Avi.
Now, I don't know, I don't claim to be an expert on this stuff, Fezzi. As I said before, you and I, not journalists.
No.
Not really even broadcast. A couple of comics who do this show, but...
barely grammatically correct.
Get to, and barely is a nice way of putting it, but we get to know a lot of these people. We wanted to open up the phones to it. I don't know the answers here. All we wanted to do is share our feelings with you folks and let you share your feelings with us. We're running a little later. We said we'd be in here, Fezzi, but let's take some of these calls.
All right.
Here is Augie. Augie, you're on Ron and Fez.
Hey, Augie.
Hello?
Yeah, buddy. What can we do for you?
I'm on a cell phone. It's crapping out on me a little bit. But, there's a lot of increased activity in the sky here. I seen their F-14s. I've seen them pass by maybe a dozen or two times. And I've seen the AWACS plane pass by. I've seen them circling around the ships out on the ocean. I'm right on the beach. Hello?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And, it looks, it's pretty eerie down here. I mean, it's so quiet. The place is deserted. There is nobody here but these planes in the sky. That's the only thing that's going on down here right now.
Yeah. I think earlier in the day, didn't the Pentagon order the USS George Washington and the USS John Kennedy to New York?
Well, yeah, they said they're sending those ships to the East Coast. I'm still waiting to see one of them.
Mm-hmm. I don't know where they were coming from.
I've been out here all day pretty much. They're checking out everything. I mean, everything on the water, all the fishing, trolling boats and everything is getting checked out. Everything. Nothing's getting by right now.
All right. Thanks a lot for calling up.
Thanks, man.
That's it.
877-692-1027.
Fezzi, let's play some 10-10 wins, and then we'll come back.
Okay.
And do one last segment with you guys. We told the boss we'd be out here at 11, but I just want to hang out a little longer.
All right. We'll check in with news coverage, the latest coming to you from 10-10 wins. Yeah.